Okay, members, thank you and good morning. I declare the meeting open to the public online. I would like to welcome the members who are participating by video conferencing this morning to assist us in maintaining the social distancing requirement. And this morning that is our Deputy Chair, Pam Cameron, Pat Sheehan attending online, and Orlea Flynn at this stage. So can I remind all members about the protocols regarding the use of electronic devices? Apologies, the committee office has received no apologies and no apologies received. Thank you. Moving on to chairperson's business then, I suppose the key issue this week is the very, very worrying and concerning situation that we see in front of us in relation to coronavirus and the amount of spread that there is and the pressure that's on the health and social care system. So I suppose just on behalf of the committee, I would just like to urge everyone to do everything they can over the next period of time to try to provide some space for some of the agencies to develop responses. We recognise these are very, very difficult restrictions for many people and that they do indeed have a knock-on impact in terms of people's well-being, in terms of their livelihoods, and those are not easy decisions. But I would urge people to abide by the need to maintain social distancing, to cut down on as many social contacts as possible, to wash your hands regularly and to wear a face covering. So the other thing is that I wanted to note in this morning's was the informal Zoom that a number of us did yesterday with care home residents and relatives to inform our inquiry into the care home sector. It was a hugely valuable and I think a very, very rich experience in terms of getting those insightful contributions from those members, deeply emotional at times, but also very positive, very helpful. They engaged in the sense of making recommendations that could be of use to us and on a forwarding basis in terms of the response. So I thought it was very useful. Do any of the members want to that were at the meeting? Pam, do you want to say anything in relation to that?
Yes, thanks, Chair. I know yourself and Paula were also there. Sorry, I'm just going to put my headphones on, getting feedback here.
Okay. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, we're hearing you now. Pam, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I'm aware that yourself and Paula were also there I'm still suffering from that meeting today. I thought it was heartbreaking, quite frankly, and it really brings home, you know, the reason for every restriction that we're facing. And we understand how difficult it is, for certain sectors in the economy, and we understand how detrimental it is to the economy. And I would just reiterate your plea for the public to maintain social distance and to take all those simple measures that we can, the wearing the face coverings, the washing your hands, sanitising, because it's not right that there are people who are so vulnerable and are ill enough that they cannot live with their relatives and they are forced apart from their relatives, and it's not right. And I think it really speaks to me about how we need to be more cognizant of the people who are at risk here and the impact that's having on them, whether they get COVID or not. If you keep this rate at this level, you're really severely risking the health of many individuals who are in health decline because of the risk of COVID, and it might not even kill them. But they're declining because they're being deprived seeing their loved ones. And I just thought it was absolutely heartbreaking. It was very worthwhile, and I'm really glad we did it. And all thanks to Louise and the assembly team who organised that. I thought it was very worthwhile. So that was all I wanted to say.
Thank you. And Paula?
Thank you. And I thought it was very powerful, I have to say. I think we were all probably in tears at one point during it. But I suppose what struck me was even some of the smallest comments and some of the smallest feedback were just threads that maybe we need to pull at. So I think the transcript from them will actually be very valuable for this inquiry, but I very much echo what others have said.
Yeah, and I agree with all of your remarks, and I want to thank everyone who participated in that for giving us their time. We deeply appreciate it. Okay, thank you, members. We'll move on. We do have quite a heavy agenda today. We're taking briefings from the Public Health Agency on contact tracing. We have a briefing on budgetary matters, and we will need to deal today with several pieces of subordinate legislation. So thank you. Moving on to draft minutes, members, I refer you there to the minutes at the on tab 3.1 of your meeting pack. Are members content with those minutes? Yep, members content, thank you. And there are no matters arising from the minutes today. So members, we have a slight change to the agenda order this morning to accommodate officials' diary pressures. If members are content, we will move now to the statutory rules on coronavirus restrictions at agenda items 9 to 11. Are members agreed? Yeah, thank you, members. So I refer members then to papers at tabs 9 to 11 of your pack. I can advise members that the Chief Environmental Health Officer is here today to brief us on the regulations before us regarding the reopening of so-called wet pubs. You will remember, members, that we considered one of these SORs at the meeting on the 8th of October and agreed to defer our decision pending further consideration today. So I'd now like to welcome by video conference.
Yeah,
did. I would.
Yeah.
We.
So thank you for the opportunity to once again brief you.
Sorry, I'm going to take a short pause. Okay, members, thank you. We're back on, and we do have Nigel McMahon now on the line with us. And so I'd now like to welcome Nigel by video conference. Mr. Nigel McMahon, Chief Environmental Health Officer. And Nigel, could you go ahead and brief us on these ASRs, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Chair, you said you wanted to reconvene your discussion on the number 5 amendment regulations before we moved on to number 6 and 7. Do you want to just go straight into more questions, or do you want me to recap on those regulations first?
Recap, yeah. Give us a recap, please, Nigel, for the benefit of the members.
Okay, certainly. SR 2020-202 is the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions number 2, Amendment number 5 regulations, Northern Ireland 2020. The number 5 regulations were made on the 22nd of September and came into operation on the 23rd. In summary, the main changes introduced are that in a venue serving alcohol or where alcohol can be bought and consumed by customers, the venue is required as part of its risk assessment process to identify the number of people who can safely be accommodated in line with social distancing requirements and must clearly display this maximum number prominently in the premises. The risk assessment must be made available on request, including to PSNI, and must be provided to somebody who books a venue. All reasonable measures to limit the risk of transmission of coronavirus must be taken. Hand sanitation stations must be in place for people to use before they enter the premises. The venue is required to collect customer details to assist with the test, trace, protect, contact tracing program. And this information must be retained for a period of 21 days from the date of the visit. All service will be at seated tables. No standing or service at the bar is permitted. Customers must remain seated once in the premises, apart from using the facilities, or to leave the premises. Where the venue provides food from a buffet, customers can also leave their table to select food from the buffet whilst maintaining 2 meters social distancing at all times. Dancing is prohibited in hospitality venues, as is live or recorded music for dancing. Live music is also prohibited. Background or ambient music is allowed at a volume which allows people to conduct normal conversation without having to raise their voice to be heard. There are exemptions for a couple getting married or entering into a civil partnership in order to facilitate the traditional first dance and for professional dancers providing entertainment at a venue. A maximum of 6 people from no more than 2 households can be seated at a table. Children aged 12 or under are not included in the total. More than 6 at a table are permitted if they belong to a single household. At an event to celebrate a marriage or a civil partnership, the maximum table size is 10 people, not including children aged 12 or under, and there's no limit on the size of the top table. In addition to the restrictions and requirements relating to the hospitality sector, the regulations also require that the PSNI be provided on request with a copy of the risk assessment and the details of the relevant measures relating to an outdoor gathering consisting of more than 15 people. The regulations also clarify that the offences can apply to an event organiser. The main regulations limiting indoor gatherings in a private dwelling to 6 people from 2 households and outdoor gatherings in a private dwelling to no more than 15 people, and a gathering in a private dwelling of up to 10 people where one of the parties in a marriage or civil partnership is terminally ill, are amended so that children aged 12 or under are not included in those totals.
That's probably a bit more detail than actually, it's more the overall, the cumulative impact of them. So that was SR 2020-204, is that right you were referring to there?
Or 202? 202.
Well, listen, I'll just give a very quick update to members on 204 and 210, and then we'll come back to questions. Just to refresh, so SR 2020/204 was the one that advised that this rule makes changes to the places where restrictions will apply. Restrictions relating to venues where intoxicating liquor may be consumed will be applicable both in outdoor and indoor spaces associated with the venue, and that and places of worship were excluded from that. SR 2020-210 was the one which advised that it inserts a definition of intoxicating liquor, it amends the restrictions on movement within a venue at which intoxicating liquor may be consumed, and adds restrictions on the opening hours of certain venues at which intoxicating liquor and food and drink may be obtained or consumed. So I understand, we do understand that these deal with kind of fairly detailed elements of that, but I suppose our question, or certainly my initial questioning around this is in relation to the more general situation. So given Wednesday's decisions, and we're being asked to confirm regulations now to reopen, these regulations reopened wet pubs without knowing anything about the circumstances in which they will be used. So why would these regulations just simply not be revoked? And then should they be necessary again in a further point in time, then brought back again?
As far as the process is concerned, Chair, as you're aware, we've been doing these via urgent procedure. So effectively, these 3 sets of regulations we're considering today are currently the law. They are currently the position as things stand today. And unless, of course, they go through committee scrutiny and the Assembly debate, then after 28 days, they will fall and no longer become the law. In terms of yesterday's announcement, I'm sure you'll appreciate that there's a lot of work to be done, quite a lot of detailed drafting to be done in terms of how the executive decisions of yesterday will actually be implemented. That may or may not involve revoking some of the previous regulations. It may involve more amendments rather than revoking elements of it. So I'm not really in a position to say at this point in time what will emerge from that. Obviously, the target is to have that in place by 6 o'clock tomorrow, and colleagues are urgently working on that at the moment. But I'm not able to say at this point in time whether the outcome of that drafting will result in the revoking of any elements of these regulations at this time.
So are you saying that they still could be revoked as a result of the drafting process?
I think that's certainly an option, Chair. We obviously have a situation now where we're imposing yet another layer of restrictions, if you will, over and above what's currently in place, given the urgency of the current situation. And it's for departmental solicitors to advise us what the best way of doing that is. It has been very difficult, but our our hope all the way through is that we can do this in a way that is as easily and best communicated as is possible. So if revoking elements of the legislation provides an opportunity to simplify that and simplify the message, then that's something obviously we would always look at.
Okay, and what circumstances would it be proposed to bring these back? So what sort of levels of transmission would you be looking at if these ones were coming back? What sort of levels of what's the advice and the evidence around the levels of transmission that would trigger a return of these ones?
Well, I don't know. I'm not involved in the discussions that the Chief Scientific Advisor, Chief Medical Officer have with the executive. I understand there's no one set trigger. There's a sort of a basket of measures and factors that are taken into account. And of course, it's always a balance as well. There is that scientific evidence, but then obviously there are other issues beyond that to try and balance regarding, you know, the economy and the impact on wider society as well. So I suppose all I can say on that is that I understand from the statement yesterday that there's a commitment to have these latest set of restrictions in place for 4 weeks. And I presume that's in order to see whether or not they're having an impact before any further decisions are taken. But I'm not really in a position to comment today on how the executive would decide at that point as to what it wishes to do from then on. But as you know, the regulations have been amended very regularly throughout the whole process, and that has largely been required to reflect the rapidly changing position. So I can't imagine that that's going to in terms of the nature of the process, that that's going to change anytime soon.
Okay, and during the period that those wet pubs have been open, how has that been monitored and measured in terms of its impact?
The Chief Scientific Advisor provides a weekly update to the executive, and the executive will be getting that update again today. And there's comments obviously within that as to whether rates are rising or falling and how that looks geographically. It's very difficult, I understand, to sort of unpick that in the sense of attributing any particular rise or fall to one of what is now quite a wide basket of measures that are in place. So it's quite difficult to think to be definitive on whether any particular intervention is having an effect or not. But obviously the overall hope is that both the measures that are in place at the moment and the new measures that are going to be introduced overall, along with people complying with them and their behaviour, will have the desired effect of pulling the rates down.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go to members now. I'll go first to Alex.
Thank you. First comment, I suppose, just it's a bit of an observation. It's almost like, you know, this is all obsolete because of what's going to happen on Friday, and it's nearly pointless. But that's just the way I feel. But my question is, does the Chief Medical Officer come to you and explain to you what he's doing for you to do these new rules and stuff? Does he explain his rationale to you? And also, is he providing you with any evidence as to why the rationale is for choosing different areas for closure or regulations, such as restaurants? Because, you know, restaurants have put so many things in place and now we're having to close them. And I'm wondering, where's the evidence for this? Because, you know, if you're going out for a meal, these guys have put up the plastic screens, they're wearing PPE, they're providing the hand sanitizers, everybody's socially distancing. And, you know, what is the evidence that they have to close that this is actually going to make any difference to, you know, reducing the cases of COVID? It's just, I just want to know the rationale for this, because we're not really getting it, are we? And we're affecting everybody's lives. You know, we're affecting the economy, and we're trying to save lives on one hand, but on the other hand, a lot of these measures are actually contributing to suicides and mental health issues. And I want to start seeing the evidence for all this. you know, we can't just keep willy-nilly doing things unless we've got the evidence to back it up. Is that okay? Yeah.
Okay, Nigel.
Yeah, I mean, on the first comment about the regulations effectively being obsolete in the process, I think we probably all share the same frustration in that the way that we're having to work through this means that we are, you know, sadly missing out a lot of the steps in the process that would normally happen. And you know, I do have sympathy for the fact that the committee are coming to this after the fact, so to speak, when the regulations are already made. And I don't think any of us would really want that in an ideal world. But I think we also understand why that's had to happen. In terms of the evidence and rationale, what I would say on that is that the evidence base and the professional advice is given by the Chief Medical Officer and Chief Scientific Advisor to the executive, and they would typically attend the executive meetings in order to give that and to clarify any points the executive may have. And then obviously the ultimate decisions that come out of that are collective and political decisions. As officials working on the side of the regulations, our job is fundamentally to implement those decisions by way of making legislation, working with departmental solicitors to draft something that matches and meets that policy intent. What I would say is not so much that the Chief Scientific Advisor, Chief Medical Officer would directly provide that advice to us as officials, but they are quite generous with their time in terms of making themselves available to clarify any points that we may have about what the policy intent may have been. Obviously, the statements that come out of the executive ultimately, you know, don't contain at times the level of detail that's required for us in terms of legislative drafting. And where we have a query about what the intent may have been there, then we are able to access Chief Medical Officer, Chief Scientific Advisor to explain, you know, that detail if we need it.
Okay, thank you. And Paula?
Thank you. Thank you for coming this morning. The SAGE advice was released on the 21st of September, which pretty much showed that the opening of the wet pubs would actually contribute to the rise in numbers. I'm just wondering how much that factored in terms of the discussions with the Chief Medical Officer and then on up to the executive in terms of their decision then a couple of days later to open the wet pubs. I'm just wondering how that all fits in.
I'm not sure I'm really able to answer the question in the sense that I'm not privy to, you know, to those conversations and discussions, so I don't really know how that went. I'm afraid the only thing I could comment that I am aware of is that the work around opening wet pubs and doing that safely was conducted at pace like everything else, but there was a lot of work done, particularly by the Department for the Economy and the Executive Office, along with stakeholders in the industry, to come up with a package where that was felt to be able to be proposed to the executive for the wet pubs to be open. It's unfortunate, of course, that with a rapidly changing situation, that the timing of that coming to fruition also was around about the time we were starting to see other increases going on. In relation to having to close them again, obviously the transmission of the virus is strongly linked to public mixing in general in a range of settings, and clearly hospitality is one of those key settings where, unfortunately, despite the measures that are in place, at times clearly there is transmission going on occasion, and so the time is right, unfortunately, to introduce these stricter requirements and restrictions again.
Okay, thank you. And I just want to pick up on points last week that were raised around the risk assessment. And you know, you talked about the police then being privy to these if they request them. I'm just wondering how much you actually engage with the councils in terms of their environmental health officers and their licensing. Obviously, they have a lot of experience of dealing with the particular pubs and licensed premises in their area. And I'm just wondering, was it an opportunity not missed to actually engage them and provide them with a role in terms of, as we said last week, making sure that they were delivering on the risk assessment and the measures that they said they were going to introduce. I just think that there would have been an opportunity there for better compliance and monitoring.
What I would say on that is that there is an enforcement group, which I'm not involved in, so I can't really talk about the detail of that, but there is an enforcement group being led by TEO that is working with the police and local government looking at that. I also know Department for Communities have been in discussions with local government about future roles as well. So councils are designated currently in terms of business closures under the original restriction regulations. And I know there are ongoing discussions with them about what future support or future role that they might be able to contribute.
Thank you. And I'm going to go then to Gerry, and then I'll be going on the phone to our Deputy Chair, Pam Cameron. So, Gerry.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Nigel. It's obviously something you'll be familiar hearing me banging on about for months now, about the evidence, and I think the evidence hasn't been forthcoming, and it's been we've moved far too quickly to lift these regulations, and unfortunately you've been in the firing line maybe, Nigel, in terms of getting some of that that heat, if you will, from myself and some others, but I think there has been a willingness to move far too quickly without the evidence, and we heard about hospitality and the high rates there, so I think a lot of the stuff is premature. Kind of similar to Alex's point, I'm kind of wondering, like, what's the rationale for us as a committee to agree to this today, effectively for it to be an operation. I know it is an operation, but by our endorsement of it today, be an operation for a period of over 24 hours, and then either a new regulation to come in or this regulation to fall. I mean, doesn't that seem a bit farcical that we're being asked to agree this for a period of, you know, almost 24 hours and then it falls? So that just seems to be bizarre to me and most people, I'd say, this building. And also, kind of what the Chair was alluding to, but I'm not clear if I've got the answer. If this is agreed by the committee today, is it a case of it's frozen effectively for 4 weeks based on the announcement on Wednesday? And then if there's a new regulation comes in and that falls, we'll go automatically back to this, or what's the situation? Because I think there's a lot of clarity needed, certainly for myself and many others.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Well, again, in terms of process, these regulations are currently the law, and we have to work with, I suppose, what's in front of us at any point in time. So it's important then that the administrative process and the scrutiny process is gone through to confirm it as the law. Whilst it's not possible for me to talk now about what drafting for the new restrictions might look like by tomorrow, there is a possibility that the new restrictions are added, if you like, as another layer on top of the existing law, one that can be removed again, potentially, hopefully, in 4 weeks' time. And if that were to be the case, then we would revert back to the provisions that we're discussing today. So I think from our perspective, it is important that we do get them on the statute book, and that they then could be relied upon in due course, if in 4 weeks' time the wider restrictions are removed again. But I'm talking to some extent hypothetically there, because it does depend on what is recommended in terms of the drafting for the weekend. But for now, we assume that these regulations will be in place and will be sitting ready to fall back to in 4 weeks' time, hopefully, if the tougher restrictions are then lifted.
Okay, I'm going to go across now to Pam Cameron and then Arlie Flynn. So Pam first, please.
Thanks, Chair, and thank you, Nigel, once again for being here. Nigel, since our last meeting, has our request for sight of the relevant advice and evidence been relayed to the Executive? That's my first question. And my second one is in and around the regulation which sets out what hospitality has to provide in terms of the social distancing measures, the hand sanitising, etc., and also the requirement to gather detail from customers. And I'm just wondering, is it specified in the regulation what exactly those details are, i.e. name, telephone number, or name, telephone number, address, because I've noticed that that differs from venue to venue, where some places you're asked for just a name and a phone number, and others you're asked for a name, address and phone number. I'm just thinking in terms of that enforcing of the no more than two households at a table, how that can be done if all the details are not gathered.
Yeah. On the first point about the executive, I'm certainly not aware that there's been anything forwarded to the executive about the request for evidence to be provided. On the point about the number five regulations, I believe the requirement around the information to be gathered is in guidance. I was just trying to check there. I'm not sure that it's specified in the regulations. I'd have to check that actually. In terms of the single household thing, my understanding is the information to be collected is often the person who the principal person who's made the booking. And a lot of hospitality venues that do this online would obviously gather the, you know, the name, email address and telephone number of the person making the booking. And I think that's primarily the information that's gathered rather than everybody in the group. And that's the information that has to be held for the 21 days.
Okay, so just for clarity, and you're going to check this out, do you think that the onus is on the person who makes the booking to provide all the details? I'm just thinking if you walk into, obviously, well, you can do it for a short time now, but if you walk into the pub at lunchtime with no booking and sit down with five of your workmates, for instance, you know, whose responsibility, or is that in law, or is that in guideline, that who checks basically that they're from no more than two households?
My comment about the person who makes the booking, I think it's just a reflection on how I suspect it probably works in practice rather than what the law actually requires. I think the venue obviously will be set out in such a way that it has tables that can only accommodate six. The venue can do no more than ask or check. If there's more than two households involved, they have a requirement to do so. I suppose there's a certain amount of taking that on good faith if they're told that that's the case. If they're looking for a bigger table because their household is more than six, and I would imagine that's something they would have to organise in advance with the venue to contact them to say, look, there's more than six of us coming here and we're all from one household. Again, I think the venue would have to take that largely on good faith that they are indeed from one household. Just checking what the regulations say about the information requirement, if I could just quickly say, what the regulations actually say is where visitor information isn't provided in advance of the visit, the venue has to obtain the visitor information at the time of the visit, record visitor information in a filing system, which can be electronic, and store it for 21 days and provide it then on request to a relevant person. So that's as much detail as the regulation actually contains. It doesn't specify everybody in the group or the nature of the information, but I suspect that's
hospitality
guidance.
Okay, I think that would need firmed up, Nigel, because you know if you're not having to provide actual addresses, it's very difficult for establishments to know whether people are complying with the law or with the guidelines. So I just think, given the call from hospitality to you know tell us what we need to do in order to stay open, because it's incredibly difficult for them, and we understand that. The vast majority of them have gone to great lengths in order to comply with regulation and guidelines, and I just feel so sorry for them, you know, coming into the next period of time where they've worked their socks off and it doesn't appear to be enough. So I just think if there are any improvements going forward that could help them in order to keep any instances which are relating to hospitality down, I think that would be a good thing. So if you wouldn't mind maybe having another look at that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I would just comment there's obviously a balance with trying to not overly burden hospitality as well. And I think from a contact tracing point of view, if they have an outbreak associated with that venue or with that particular group, then obviously if they have the contact details of the person who made the booking, then contact tracing, I imagine, would follow up with them in terms of who was in your group and what were their details. And that takes the burden and the onus off the hospitality venue having to take all of those details from everybody who comes. So I think there is a balance here as well in trying to, yes, make hospitality venues safe, but not put any more burden than is necessary on them in terms of putting people off visiting and going out to use the premises.
Thank you.
Okay, and Arlia, going to Arlia there on the phone. Are you there, Arlia?
Yep, I am. Thanks, and thanks, Nigel. I suppose it does seem a wee bit bizarre to be discussing the regulations coming into force now that they've been sort of overtaken by the four-week amendments that we're going to see over the next couple of weeks. So I'm just wondering, Nigel, could the next 4 weeks be used as an opportunity for the department, even for us as a health committee, to try and look at more detail into some of the evidence? I don't know, because you may have to, again, chop and change and amend this regulation in a month's time anyway, because we don't know where we're going to be in 4 weeks' time. So, and obviously this regulation as it stands, it's talking about obviously the limitations on live music and dancing, but then you had the exemption for the marriages and things like that, which we know is obviously all going to change over the next couple of weeks. So is it a possibility to try and, could the department use this as an opportunity to try and gather and consider all of the evidence at how the wet pubs got on over the past way? And I'm just thinking, can we use this as an opportunity to try and even for the committee to try and have that scrutiny role in a wee bit more detail? Because obviously Pam's point around, even that around the consumer details and how that links in with the contact tracing, and then Paula's point around the enforcement issues as well. I'm just conscious that obviously you had mentioned that, there is an enforcement group that's in place under the executive office and the Department for Communities and stuff. So even as a committee, if we were able to start teasing out more of that detail over the next couple of weeks, could that be something that could be done, or is it a case that it needs to be passed even though it's already been overtaken by the new regulations?
Well, in terms of the evidence more broadly, obviously the Chief Scientific Advisor has made himself available to the committee on a number of occasions now, including the last session that we had on the regulations, to talk about the advice, and it may well be that that's something the committee want to explore more in the coming weeks in terms of the broad evidence. There may be something coming out of the work on contact tracing, enforcement group and so on and so forth. I suppose the difficulty from our perspective working on the legislation is that there are other aspects of all of this that we're not sort of directly involved in. Certainly when the committee has asked before about things like enforcement and PSNI enforcement and the Public Prosecution Service, we have gone to those bodies to request that information on the committee's behalf, but it's not something that on the legislation side we would regularly see. I'm not sure if it's really an answer to your question. All I would say is that we're more than happy to do anything that we can to try and pull information together to help support the committee on that. But at times it won't necessarily be information that we hold directly, and we may have to go to others in order to get that.
But sorry, Nigel, thank you and appreciate that response. But I suppose what my point was if, and I didn't obviously make it clear enough, once we'll come out of the period of the next 4 weeks and the regulations that are obviously going to come into place on Friday evening, so in this time in 4 weeks, whenever those regulations have expired. You know, the department, yourselves, the department won't know if these regulations that we're looking at today, how do we know if they're still going to be relevant in 4 weeks' time? Do you know what I mean? So
yeah. Mm-hmm.
How do you get around that if you need, you need to start chopping and changing? So if we pass this today, but you need to make amendments depending on how the next 4 weeks are.
Yeah.
Sorry, I was trying to tease out a wee bit.
No, I think that's a fair point, and certainly something I'll take away in terms of something that we should look at. I suppose I was focusing more on what could we provide to the committee over that period of time, and that may be a little bit more difficult, but I'm quite happy to take the point away about using the intervening period to see if there is any evidence that that these restrictions that we're discussing today have had any impact up to this point.
Thanks, Nigel.
Okay, Nigel, and just given that the confirmatory process is designed to that the committee would confirm, or these regulations will be confirmed when you have seen the impact and how well they're working, and given that there have been issues raised today that are still outstanding about how they're working, would it not be just simpler to revoke them and to build in what you know? Because we're obviously looking at these now. They've already been overtaken by events, and we don't know what things will look like in 4 weeks' time. Would it not be simpler to revoke and then draft them again based upon the learning that we have gleaned from this period of time, and we build that into the new regulation to fine-tune it?
Chair, that's something that certainly has been considered as one of the options over the last 24 hours, and may well be the route that we take. There are other ways of doing this as well, and I would just add that one of the things we need to be very careful of is that you'll be aware that the executive are considering the potential financial package for businesses today. And there's a very strong link between the way that the legislation is drafted and worded and business eligibility for that package. So the two sort of have to marry together. So we will, in a sense, have to wait to see what the financial package looks like and what the criteria of that is before we draft the legislation. In drafting, we're not inadvertently excluding businesses from financial support that would otherwise have got it. You'll know that there's a financial package already agreed linked to the element of the regulations for dairy and Strabane. So again, we need to have a detailed look at how new drafting would work in terms of delivery of the financial package. That's probably all I can say at the moment, but that is an additional and very important factor that we need to look at in the drafting, and to that extent, then the model that's adopted may have to fit in with that.
Okay, and am I to take it from what you're saying, Nigel, that there is active consideration going on within the department and by the minister at this point in time as to whether to revoke or move these at this stage?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's the case. Yeah.
Okay, and going back to, you said that you weren't aware that our request for further information that has been provided to the executive be relayed. Why is that, given how many times we have asked you to do that?
Well, I'm not sure, Chair, that in these sessions that I've been asked to relay that to the executive. I think we've simply said, you know, when asked about the evidence, that the evidence is provided for the executive, and it's up to the executive to make a decision as to whether to publish that or make that available. I'm not entirely sure that it would be my other department's role to do that. I would have to take advice on that as to whether that's something would be appropriate for us to do on the basis of a briefing session.
Well, can you undertake to do that and to the next time you're back to the committee to address that issue, and indeed to relay the request to the executive, because we do want to have the additional assessment. And while Professor Young was here, I don't feel the issue has been addressed, and I think we will be returning to it. Okay, Nigel, thank you. We're going to move on to our committee consideration, but thank you for coming this morning as ever and dealing with the members' questions. Thank you, and we'll see you again.
Okay. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, members. So, members, can I advise that before we formally consider each of the regulations, I can inform members the Department has advised that the motions in these SRs will be brought forward by the Department for Communities in the week beginning 19th of October. And so this is the last opportunity for the committee to come to its decision on these regulations prior to the Assembly debate. The Examiner of Statutory Rules has advised that she will report on these SRs tomorrow and raise no issues. All three are subject to confirmatory resolution. So what are members' views or thoughts on this at this point in time? Jerry?
Just a repeat, sure. It just seems bizarre, and anybody who's watching this from outside would be like, you know, why is the committee agreeing to an SR or rule, a change, which is going to have operation tomorrow evening? So I don't know why we need to. I'm assuming, based on Nigel's...
Can you hear us? We can't really hear what Jerry's saying.
Sorry, apologies. Apologies.
Okay, we can hear you, Orlea, and Pam, we're hearing you now, so Jerry's going to move a little closer.
The sound quality is very ropey.
Me too.
Same in Newcastle.
Okay. Members, in light of that, I'm going to suspend to see if we can get that improved, because it's obviously not satisfactory for you not to be able to hear what's being discussed. So I'm going to suspend.
This is the Northern Ireland Assembly. Programme sound.
Okay, members, thank you. So, members, we're now moving on to item 5, COVID, a part of our COVID-19 disease response, and we are this morning taking a briefing from the Public Health Agency and the Chief Digital Information Officer on testing and contact tracing. I can advise members that officials from the Public Health Agency are here today, along with the Department's Chief Digital Information Officer, to update the committee on their work on testing and contact tracing and use of the Stop COVID app. I refer members to papers at tab 5 of your pack, and I'd now like to welcome via video link from the PHA, Ms. Olive MacLeod, Interim Chief Executive, Dr. Joanne McLean, Public Health Consultant, Professor Hugo Van Weerden, Director of Public Health, Dr. Jerry Waldron, Head of Health Protection, and from the Department of Health, and Mr. Dan West, Chief Digital Information Officer, and finally, Dr. Breed Farrell, who is Assistant Director of Service Developments. I would like to now ask the officials to brief the meeting, and I would ask you to keep your briefing as succinct as possible, please, because we're keen to get to members' questions. So thank you, and go ahead with your briefing, please.
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity once again to brief the committee. We're pleased to update you and have submitted a brief to you. The team and I are here to answer your questions, and we're happy to use the time as constructively as possible to allow you to ask the questions. So I'll pause there.
Okay. Thank you. Well, the situation that we're facing at the present time, and we're all acutely aware of the context where we are today in relation to having been forced into a situation where additional measures have had been brought through of a restrictive nature in order to get control of the virus. Obviously, we are asking people to do an awful lot in relation to that, and we're asking them to abide by quite restrictive measures and to change their behaviours, to abide by all the regulations in order to assist. However, each and every one of us, in terms of this building and in terms of your work, also have a responsibility in terms of what is being delivered from a public health perspective. In relation to the tracing operation that you're involved in, I am aware of dozens of cases, and I'm aware that all reps across a wide area are picking up on cases of difficulties with getting testing of delays in getting testing results back, and of situations and clear examples where no contact tracing is taking place. We're also in a situation where we are seeing very little information in terms of what areas are causing transmission, other than kind of headline figures about its community transmission and things like that. There's very, very little levels of detail. But my first question is in relation to the contact tracing. And it's clear that the countries who are doing this better are testing much more and tracing much more rigorously. And they are also testing asymptomatic cases and tracing then down the contacts of those. So can you tell us what the plans are at the present time in relation to asymptomatic testing, and why we're not carrying out asymptomatic testing and then the tracing of those contacts to try to get ahead of this virus?
Thank you. Okay. Yes, I will hand over to Dr. Jerry Waldron.
Good morning, Chair. Currently, as you correctly say, the testing is by and large on symptomatic cases, and the test that we have works best actually when symptoms are present. It's not a good test for population testing in general, because there can be quite a lot of false positives when we test asymptomatic individuals. There very well may come a time in terms of where we're going where asymptomatic testing will be done, but that's going to be a policy decision that will need to be taken at another level. We do currently recommend
Dr. Waldron, and I do understand your point about the community testing, but I take it that's a capacity issue. But let's even set that aside for a second. In relation to key frontline healthcare staff, who we so desperately need in this period of time, and we are aware of the very great difficulties there are at present, should we be testing those asymptomatically? And I just want to, for example, to point out to you, I asked the Minister about this in the Assembly Chamber on the 6th of October, and he advised that one of our strengthening tools is our testing of care homes, which this committee had urged, not just residents but staff. The Chair will be aware that yesterday's figures showed that we have 28 care homes with positive supported patients. Of those 28, 24 were identified through our testing programme, which picked up residents or staff who may have been asymptomatic. Does that not indicate that we need to be testing key staff who are asymptomatic once we have established there's been a contact?
I think what you've identified is the programme, and quite a successful programme, as you said, for care homes, where there's regular testing there. It's important, and again, it was a policy decision that took place, and it's important in the context of care homes. The primary purpose there, in terms of asymptomatic testing, is protection of the vulnerable individuals who happen to be in the care homes. That's why it's a priority. It may be necessary to bring that in the future for other groups. But I think when you're talking about asymptomatic testing, and I think it's a very important point not to get conflated with the fact of what a positive test, or sorry, what a negative test actually means. Because in the context of an individual who is a contact of someone who's tested positive, and that doesn't really matter whether it's in a hospital setting or any other setting, that someone who subsequently is tested and being asymptomatic, in the event of getting a positive test, if they are a contact, it doesn't make any difference in terms of the length of isolation that they need to undergo. And that's an important consideration for healthcare services as well. Introducing testing on asymptomatic contacts in the setting of the health service or any other area will not release individuals for further work. The important thing in all of this is to be keeping the appropriate precautions, social distancing, hand washing, etc., but particularly social distancing, so that when some individual tests positive, that the amount, the number of contacts will actually be minimal. And that's the situation. I was about to say earlier as well that there are and there will be situations where we will recommend other situations outside of care homes where we will recommend asymptomatic testing. And that's in the context of outbreaks. And if, for instance, there's a workplace where we discover that there are a lot of positive cases and we can't track them back to specific incidents or clusters, that we would then, or we may then recommend selective testing of all asymptomatic individuals in that workplace so that we can identify the asymptomatic positives in that workplace and their contacts and exclude them from the workplace. That's the current situation that we're in. Things may change, and as we know, during the context of COVID-19, things are changing all the time, and we have to keep up with those changes and respond to those changes. But that is the current situation with regard to testing of asymptomatic individuals.
Okay, and we, the committee, do understand that things change all the time. However, in June, when it was very clear that we were facing into what was going to be a difficult winter, we were aware that schools were going to reopen in September. We were aware that there was going to be a second wave of coronavirus, and we were aware that winter pressures existed within the system, and there was going to be the flu season was going to be on us. So a blind man on a galloping horse could have seen that we were going to need significant testing and tracing capacity at this point. And with the problems I have mentioned to you, is it the case that there wasn't enough done over the summer to prepare us, and that the testing and tracing system has struggled to keep pace with demand?
Well, I think you mentioned three things there, Chair, and I think two of them are absolutely correct in terms of the schools and in terms of the winter pressures. And believe me, we were very much aware that that was happening. It was by no means inevitable that we would get a second wave. When things started reducing, we were very, very conscious of the fact that there was a risk that once people came out of lockdown and went back in to the community, as they had to do, as it was absolutely right to start reducing the restrictions. But we were warning all along of the dangers of complacency and the risk that if people were not maintaining the important factors in terms of, particularly in terms of social distancing, but also wearing a face covering and hand hygiene, and especially that when people were advised that they were testing positive or were contacts of confirmed cases, they should have been they should have been self-isolating. We put out those, and our comms messaging went out time and time again whilst there was a low number of cases. We did have time for respite in that. During that time, we were preparing. We introduced a contact tracing service long before other areas introduced that. And we were coping very, very well with that, even better than that. We were identifying clusters. We were putting measures in place in terms of and moving very well. What we did not anticipate was that at this stage of the year in October, that we would have the unprecedented numbers of positive cases that we have. But despite all of that, we have been working extremely hard to deal with what's coming in. We have been innovating. We have introduced digital processes for that, that I'd be very happy for myself and other people to cover that if the committee needs further information on that. But it's a sign of how we are responding to the unprecedented and extraordinary circumstances that that we are being faced with, and we will continue to do.
Sorry, Dr. Waldron. How many? So you've said that you didn't anticipate how many positive cases there would be, and I think the fact that we're returning now 18 to 20% positives show that our testing system hasn't scaled up. But how many positives did you anticipate, and did you prepare for at this point?
Chair, the modelling suggested that we would be dealing with 300 cases at the end of September, and we had more than adequate staff to deal with that. However, you will know on the 2nd of October, it jumped by 300% to almost 900, and we have been able to flex up to deal with this demand. It has been very challenging. We have been recruiting over the summer, and we continue to recruit. We have many people who have returned from retirement to help us. And we have a total of 151 staff with 25 in training, We have increased our capacity in our county hall in Ballymena. We've doubled the capacity. We have our teams working remotely now. As Dr. Waldron has said, we have innovated. We're using technology to reach people to ensure that they understand their responsibilities. We are using our communications to effectively support people to make the right decisions. We will continue to flex up and respond to the demand in relation to contact tracing. But I think it's a tribute to our staff, how well they have worked. We run our service over 7 days, 12 hours a day, and reached almost 900 people yesterday in relation to positive cases.
Yeah, no, I don't think anyone is questioning the contribution and the dedication of the staff. All of what we're questioning is, are there enough of them and are they well enough resourced? And what I would like to ask then, as a result of your last comment, in relation to anticipating 300, but that increasing by 300%, how much of that 300% increase was based on the failure of the testing and tracing system to keep abreast with demand?
So I'm grateful for the opportunity to present in relation to this and recognise the importance of the focus on test and trace. I can reassure the committee that I believe we have a very high quality test and trace system in Northern Ireland. We were the first in the UK to have one off the block. We were the first to have a proximity app. We have managed to keep up with demand as it's progressed, by and large. There is... the evidence is that the test and trace service would reduce R by 5 to 15% in general, and I do believe we are having that degree of impact on the R factor. The key here really is that large sectors of society understandably eased up too much when we came out of lockdown. There has been very effective messaging, but it is understandable that people felt frustrated and have not really been sticking to the simple rules that have been advised and that the committee are very familiar with. The test and trace the service is an important part of the infrastructure, but I do believe that it is contributing the proportion that it should be. Can I just say very, very briefly, what happens is everybody gets a text message to say that they've got a positive test. Then the next morning, about 8:30 in the morning, they'll get another text message to reinforce that they must self-isolate. The vast majority of people will then get a phone call as well. We are also looking at a follow-up text message, reminder message that you must self-isolate. So we are putting in a multi-stage approach whereby we are able to continually reinforce the message. There is evidence from England, for example, that a proportion of people, despite that intense messaging, do not continue to self-isolate. But I think that is distinct from the role of that we can perform. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And just before I go to members, and finally from me for now, on the 27th of May, this document was produced, a test, trace, isolate and support strategy. Now, it was contributed to by Chief Medical Officer, by Dr. Farrell, by Professor Young, yourself, Professor Van Weerden, Don West, all contributed to this document. It says on page 5, chains of transmission can only be broken if those who could transmit the disease to others are isolated and get the support they need to maintain that isolation. So my question is, where is the isolation and support strategy in our system at present? We talk about test, trace and protect. There's no mention of isolate. There's no mention of support. And actually, find is also a key element. But in terms of support, given your own assertions within the document, what's your role in terms of isolating? And you have to be able to trace the right people to isolate them and then supporting them.
I agree that self-isolation is tough. It is really, really tough to be in a room or in very restricted circumstances. It's emotionally draining. It's hard work. And I think that we are, as I say, are using text messaging to support. We also have a health improvement team who have over 500 contracts with community groups across Northern Ireland, and that health improvement workforce has sought very much to recognise the emotional well-being needs and sought to redirect as much as possible the contracts that we have across the community to use those contracts to support individuals who are going through a difficult time in relation to self-isolation. We, you know, there are the local authorities as well have recognised the difficulty of this and are seeking to be supportive to communities in relation to self-isolation. I think that there is, it's a societal response. We need families, we need friends to be encouraging and supportive. And the messaging from yourselves that you value and are grateful to people for self-isolating, I think makes a huge difference as well. Thank you.
Okay, and finally, just before I do go to members, one of you mentioned there that we are putting in place systems. Should these systems not have been put in place throughout June, July, August and September? Is this an acknowledgement that what has been put in place has failed?
I think, Chair, that from that point of view, these systems that we are putting in place now are systems that would have been put in place in any event, and they're enhancing the service that was already in place. We might have said that they have been put in place earlier than we were normally would have put it into place because of the numbers we're experiencing at the moment. Every innovation needs time to bed in. In this case, it's something that would have been put in, was planned to be put in, and is coming in earlier than it would otherwise have come in. But it does, like everything, it needs the time. It took some time to put the contact tracing system into place. Dan is on the line and he'll be able to tell you how long it took from inception to the app coming in. Things have to take a little bit of time to ensure that when they do come in, that they'll be performing to the optimum level. But at the same time, when things have to be brought forward, it's absolutely appropriate that they're brought forward.
And as public health officials, are you satisfied with the testing part of this system? Is at yesterday, I think it was 18.3% positives. Is that adequate testing?
So I think Dr. Breed Farrell will want to respond as well, but I think I just like to give a high level overview. At the very early stages of the pandemic, we had very little testing capacity, so it had to be used fairly judiciously. Over the summer, there was virtually spare testing capacity. But I do think that going forward into the winter, there may well be, it's important to acknowledge at this stage, some degree of gap between the testing capacity we would love to have and what we will realistically have. And I think that that will require some prioritisation of testing. But it would be good to get Dr. Farrell's response.
And yet we were told recently that resource is not an issue here. It's clearly then a failure to plan and get it into place at a time when it was necessary.
The testing capacity is at about 6,000. There is work going on to increase that. There is a global shortage of these very expensive machines that are required to do testing. It's not the sort of thing that one can turn on in a short period of time. The tests are incredibly complex tests. There is exciting work happening about much, much simpler tests, saliva tests and other tests that are rapid point of care testing, which will complement the very complex PCR testing, which I think in a few months' time will be used in much more restricted circumstances, and there'll be much more access to, as I say, these new salivary tests that are coming through. So we are globally on a developmental journey around the testing capacity and equipment. And I think Northern Ireland across, we have support from the UK on what's called Pillar 2 testing, and Northern Ireland has been privileged in that we've been allowed to use more than our population share of testing in that context, so for which we're grateful.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go to Paula.
Thank you very much for this coming along this morning. About 3 days ago, I think the figure was sitting at 36 people have been fined £1,000 for not complying with self-isolation. I'm just wondering if you could speak to that, because I'm concerned that this is probably part of the reason why we are continuing to have such high rates of transmission, and specifically around your relationship with the police and ensuring that that information flows to them whenever you feel, or how you are picking up that people aren't self-isolating.
Right. I think it's an important point that you make about enforcement and fines, and you know, that's an area that is going to have to be considered for possibly further than it is. But I'm very clear in terms of my personal view, possibly, in that once you get to the level of enforcement, certainly in relation to individuals, that things have got to too far a level, and we're beginning to lose the battle on it. We rely very, very much on the behaviour of people to do the right thing when they have either when they're going out and about their daily business and supposed to be social distancing, etc., or when they're supposed to be social isolating. We rely on the community, we rely on businesses to do the appropriate things. I feel that in terms of enforcement, that one should be concentrating, if one has to, on the more flagrant breaches of that, rather than getting it into the stage where people feel they're only doing it because they might get a fine if they don't do it. We need to have people engaged in terms of what they need to do, and doing exactly what people were doing during the lockdown. I've always said that the people of Northern Ireland behaved magnificently in taking the messages to heart during the lockdown. And if we can only get that spirit back again, we will get in a better place in terms of dealing with what's going on. There is a role for enforcement, but it's by no means should be the single thing to do or the single approach.
I wasn't suggesting it should be the single approach. My concern is that I've heard of a lot of people sort of finding excuses why they don't need to self-isolate, and how they could, you know, they're a little bit more special than others. So I think my concern really is around the rising figures and the non-compliance of self-isolation and how that has contributed. But my second question is around the advice that was given to universities from the Public Health Agency over the summer and even before that, in terms of bringing the students back and their interaction with the universities themselves, so that they can actually prepare and then also then engage with the students around when, you know, any decisions they take around the evidence for those. So if you could speak to the universities, please.
Yes, of course. And it was in terms of inviting the students back, we have had our students coming back. We've had extensive discussions with the universities going way back. We were meeting on a very regular basis in advance of the university term starting. And what we were getting at that stage was it wasn't simply a matter of people coming back, that both universities, Ulster and Queen's, were conducting quite a lot of their material, wherever possible, online. So the necessity for students to actually come back wasn't as great as it would have been in previous years. There was always going to be an issue when large numbers of students did come back, and we were very much aware of that, and we were in discussions with the universities and advice on how that was going to be handled. The universities had in place at a very early stage, Queen's, as it, for example, had their own COVID dashboard in terms of tracking the students that would be reported to them, and they've been using that. But again, and it's not picking out students for particular mention, but it's just, this is what we've been seeing throughout society, that people haven't been taking the advice that we've been giving to them, particularly in respect of social gatherings. That should not have been happening, because in a social gathering, people come together, if it only takes one infected individual in that gathering, and suddenly we have a large number of cases. Those kind of situations were happening, you might say almost inevitably, when the students returned. from home to universities, and compounded by the fact that in Northern Ireland we have a specific issue with students that maybe it doesn't exist in other areas to the same extent, about students travelling home at weekends and potentially and probably taking the infection back with them. So it was a difficult situation, but it was no different to what we've been warning about all along in terms of the dangers of having social gatherings where the 2 meter social isolation cannot be maintained, and people being, to be quite honest about and frank about it, people being careless in those situations and allowing infection to spread. Not sure what could have been done about that, other than advising everybody to stay at home, but we have been doing everything in our power in working with the universities and advising them appropriately. And we will continue to do that, and are continuing to do that.
Thank you. Just to come back just very quickly on that, the CH estimate that student travel alone contributes 0.5 to the R number in GB. I'm just wondering, did you give specific advice to the universities, or were you more just engaging with them based on this, the scientific evidence, like I've just read out there from CH? Did you give them specific advice or recommend that they did not bring the students back?
We didn't make such a recommendation. That would be up to the universities and up to the individual students and the individual courses. The advice we gave to the universities is the same advice we've been giving to everyone concerned, but specifically directed towards the universities in respect of the problems they were facing and the issues they were facing. And it's in that respect, it's no different than the advice that needs to go out to every part of society in Northern Ireland.
Okay, I'm going to go then. I'm going at this stage, I have Orlea, Jerry, Pam and Pat. So Orlea, your question, please. Yeah, just checking, Orlea, we can't hear you there at present. Are you off mute?
Yes.
Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we're hearing you now.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask a question around the issue around the testing of asymptomatic people. I know this morning that I heard the chief scientific advisor was doing some media, and he was actually posed the same question around, you know, what can we do to try and improve the testing and the contact tracing process? And he did say that that they are looking at bringing in new measures, bringing in additional measures with new testing models arriving on the scene. So I would just like to ask the panel if they have any further detail on what those new testing models might be. That's my first question, and then I'll have one additional question after that. Thank you.
Yep, thank you, Ernie. Yep.
Chairman, can I answer
that? So I'll try and pick that up. O'Brien's going to pick it up.
Okay. As Dr. Waldron mentioned earlier, the current test that's undertaken is a swab test. But there are a number of new technologies that we're hoping to pilot in the next couple of weeks in Northern Ireland, and to check if they have the same accuracy and they can be used for testing more people and doing more frequent testing. That includes a combination of, one of them is a potential saliva test, which we hopefully will be able to pilot in either healthcare staff or universities. We're still working out the detail. The other developing technologies are point of care testing that you can do at the patient's bedside, or you can do what they call rapid testing, whereby at the moment the point of the PCR test, depending on which testing platform you use, it can take up to 24 hours or to get a result back. But some of these rapid tests potentially can give a result within 60 to 90 minutes. And if they're performed in a laboratory setting, you can get quite significant throughput of tests. So there's a lot of discussion going on about this week, and I expect that we will receive information about new technology pilots in Northern Ireland, hopefully early next week.
Okay, thank you. And I suppose then would the idea be maybe then to have those new testing models, if the pilots are successful, in operation for, you know, November or December? Have you sort of set yourselves any guideline to sort of work towards there?
Well, as we speak, when we get these tests over, we will have to check that they actually measure what they're supposed to measure. That's the first thing. Then we have to check the logistics and work out the logistics of getting a good uptake of the test so that we can it will achieve its objectives. And running in parallel with that, there would be, assuming that the pilot goes well, the capacity to support more widespread use. That is being actively discussed at the same time. So for the pilots, we will have to put in very careful evaluation to make sure that they are actually achieving the impact that is expected of them.
Okay, thank you very much. That's really useful. And my final question is just around the telephone interviews with people who have tested positive and the close contacts of those who have tested positive. I know that the text message service is obviously in operation, and I'm in self-isolation myself after coming into close contact with someone who tested positive with COVID-19. So just to say, I did get that text message extremely swiftly and follow the advice. But what I'm really concerned about, Gerry, you had touched on earlier on, it's just around that sense of maybe complacency that's setting in amongst some people. And I mean, even just speaking personally, I sincerely believe that if you were able to step up the structured telephone interviews, you know, even alongside the text messaging service, I do think that it would make a difference, because it's one thing getting the text message and understanding the seriousness of following the steps and what to do. But I would be of the view that if it was possible, if you have the staff in place, they could be following up all of those contacts with an actual direct phone call, you know, that's advising people, this is what you need to do, A, B and C. I think it would make a major, major difference, but I'm not sure the 151 staff and the 25 in training, if that would allow to have that capacity, or if you can work towards that.
Thanks, Orla. When our numbers were lower and we were modelling for 300, we specifically chose a model where we would have people from professional backgrounds, nurses, social workers, psychologists, dentists, who are used to dealing with people, because this is not a call centre. We are dealing with people who are in distress, who are frightened, who have a lot of fears. And we had the luxury earlier to spend a lot of time, and our phone calls were up to 45 minutes. So we were providing a lot of guidance and support. But as you can imagine, as the numbers ramped up very quickly, we had to shorten the time we spent on the phone with people. And in fact, we had to take a risk-based approach to those, perhaps like yourself, who may have been regarded as a lower risk group and believed that a text was enough. We are ramping up. We are employing more people. We are hoping that, in fact, we'll get some student nurses to work with us, so we have the luxury to get to allow everybody to get a phone call, so they get that opportunity to speak to somebody who has that sympathetic ear and can provide them with some advice and support. As we said at the outset, we were planning for about 300 people. We were well staffed for 300 phone calls and their contacts, but it just took off. But we're catching up quickly, and that was our belief when we set this service up, that this was a service to support people as well as give the advice. Thank you.
I'm coming back into the room then to Gerry, and then I'll be going to Pam and then Pat.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, panel. And I want to thank the PHA. I've got some advice myself in the last few weeks, and it was important and helpful. So thanks to the staff members who assisted with that. I want to kind of hone in on some of the stuff that the Chair was coming on to. I mean, we have agreed as a committee to try and have a zero COVID strategy, and I don't know if we're fully equipped capacity-wise to embark upon that. I know New Zealand have adopted that strategy, and just in the last few days they've had stadiums full of people watching rugby and sport events. They've tested 1 million people out of a population of 4 million. So to me, it does seem we do need to have more testing for people obviously who are asymptomatic, but also people who haven't been contacted by the system, who maybe didn't have their Bluetooth on or, you know, fell between the cracks of any system, which is obviously possible and likely. So I just want to ask, do we need to ramp up our testing capacity is my first question.
Could I answer, please?
Yeah, go ahead,
yes.
Dr. Farrell.
Yeah. Just to say, we have ramped up our testing capacity in the last 2 weeks by 2,000 tests a day since the date, since the Friday when we had the trebling of cases notified to us. So we have been able, through the national initiative, we have been able to ramp up our testing capacity up by the order of 2,000 tests a day. As well as that, we're also seeking to increase our testing capacity in our health and social care labs, and we think there's further scope for further expansion of testing there. So it's something that we're continually trying to increase capacity, and like I say, the new technologies, we'll know more about those in early next week, and we'll know if they've been successful in getting some of those pilots for Northern Ireland. So we are actively working on this all the time on a continuous basis.
Okay, thanks for that. And just if you can answer, do we know how many tests have been carried out in total? Another concern is my understanding is that employers, if they have a staff member who has contacted or tested positive, they don't have to automatically notify other staff members. So I think there's possibilities there for changing that to make sure staff do know when their colleagues have tested positive for COVID. Just a final question. I think it was in Vietnam or other countries, there's door-to-door contact tracing or on the ground, whatever the technical medical term is for it. I mean, technology is obviously important, but we saw through the committee today, it can be limited, it can be disrupted and so on and so forth. But is there any rationale or consideration for a on the ground person contact tracing system, which obviously, you know, keeps people safe, people wear masks and so forth. But to me, it seems to be some merit in at the very least considering that approach. Thanks.
Yes, if I could maybe take both of those. I think it's an important point that you raise in terms of employers, and employers have a responsibility. We have been in touch with a number of employers during the course of the pandemic and advising them, and our advice would be that they should be proactive in what they're doing, and when they identify someone in their workforce, and this is even before they can come into contact with contact tracing, because you will have a symptomatic person in the workforce who may or may not subsequently test positive. Those individuals, that individual should be excluding themselves from the work as quickly as possible. And some employers, the more responsible employers, have got policies in place. And even at that stage, they're identifying individuals within the workforce who would be termed to be contacts of the symptomatic individual who goes off work, and advising them to stay away from work. When an individual tests positive, then proactive employers are advising the contacts. And the important thing in that respect is that the people at risk within the workforce are the individuals tested positive, obviously, and the individual that they have come in contact with. If there are protective elements within the workforce, that wouldn't necessarily mean the entire workforce would need to leave work. So there, it's a matter of employers being proactive, because it's in their best interest at the end of the day, and it's in the interest of the workforce as well, because they have a duty of care to the workers. So we have we encourage employers to put those procedures in place. The second issue you brought up about door-to-door, and that indeed has taken place in other areas. You probably recall when they had the big outbreak in Leicester, that there was, because it was confined to a particular geographical area, that individuals, that contact tracers went door-to-door in that to encourage people to get testing. And that was in the context there of asymptomatic population testing when a specific population had been identified. That certainly is something that we could and should consider if we come across a situation like that where we have, for example, a discrete geographical area where it looks like there is quite a high number, and door-to-door might be an option there. We wouldn't be ruling out any specific option. It's just that we haven't had a circumstance yet in Northern Ireland where we would need to do that. But I think we do need to consider every single possible way of getting to the bottom of the situation and breaking the chain of transmission.
Can I just supplement that by saying we have used mobile testing, mm-hmm. which is an intermediate step, and thinking very carefully about where that's deployed. And testing facility was opened up in the Holy Lands in anticipation of the fact that the student community coming back to that area and a number of other populations in that area might benefit from very immediate access to testing.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going then to Pam, then Pat, then Colin. Go ahead, Pam.
Thank you, panel, for being here today. And can I just say from the outset, I think it's incredibly important that the work you're doing, and I think it's very much appreciated, certainly from my point of view. I know it's clear to see how intensely you've been working and adapting to deal with what is a very challenging situation. I have so many questions, but I'll have to try and limit them. First one off the bat is around the subject of pooling of testing. Are you considering that in order to maximise testing capacity? And I also wanted to ask then around schools, and given that schools are taking the lead on identifying contacts in education settings, is there not a need to ensure that the advice provided to staff and pupils is consistent and clear? And have PACs or protocols been prepared for staff and parents? And if not, why not? And then one for Dan, because I think he's getting left out of all this. He's not getting any questions. How is the Stop COVID NI, the under 18 app version, how is that working? And what has the uptake been on that?
Okay, could I answer the first part of that question? To answer the first part of your question in relation to pooling of samples, yes, that has been actively considered at the moment and is one of the suggestions for a pilot using that approach, and we'll know more about it possibly next week.
Excellent.
Okay, thank you for the opportunity to answer the question on schools. Pam, my name is Joanne McLean, and I'm one of the doctors here, and I have been working with colleagues to set up a special support service for schools. So we have a special team within the public health agency staffed by senior healthcare professionals, always with a consultant on the floor to support, and we're providing direct support for schools. So we'll just talk you through what we're doing. We have given PACs, but we actually do a lot more than that as well. So what happens is, as you know, schools are identifying close contacts among staff and students within their population. And I want to say at the outset, they're doing an absolutely amazing job and they've worked so hard and so well for us to do this well. So I'll describe what we do. So whenever a child tests positive or a member of staff tests positive, they will quite often ring the principal almost immediately. So the principal will know they have a case in their school. And what happens then is the principal rings our team. We're here 7 days a week. And we begin to support them to identify the contacts. First thing we do is we share with them an information pack and a contact tracing sheet, which they have had in advance because it's been widely circulated by EA. So we walk them through that and we help them identify the close contacts within the school. So close contacts within the school are the people who have been very near the child. In primary schools, they're operating, as you know, bubbles, so it tends to be the whole class. In secondary schools, it tends to be a bit more complicated. So we identify the close contacts, the staff and the students, identify the people who are close contacts and need advice to isolate. We then give the principal a letter, which is specific to their school and specific to that case, and tells the staff and the parents, you've been in contact with a case of COVID, you're a close contact, and the date of contact was this, and you need to isolate up to and including this date. That is then given to the parents or the members of staff by the principal, and that generally happens quite quickly. That letter goes out then. Then we also have more general information for schools and for parents whose children aren't close contacts. Okay, so that's what happens with a single case, and as I say, we're here 7 days a week. The other thing we do then with schools is, because schools are part of our community, the staff and the children, they don't live in the school in isolation, of course, they're living out in the community, so what's happening in schools largely reflects what's happening in the community. So it's not uncommon for schools to have more than one case. If schools are getting more than one case, again, we work with the principal, we do a risk assessment, we see are there any links between the cases, what are the community links, what is happening here, and we're taking a really close eye on every single school with cases. So I hope that kind of summarises what we're doing. So yes, we have PACs, yes, we have information, but we actually have a dedicated team that's responding really quickly to schools and cases in the school.
Thank you, Dr. McLean. Thank you. And moving on then to Pat Sheehan. Pat, there, are you off mute and ready? Yep, go ahead.
I'm here now. The CMO told us as far back as May that there were going to be 400-600 people involved in contact tracing. And you yourself, Olive, mentioned a figure of 500 people at one time. Actually, how many full-time equivalents are involved in contact tracing at the minute?
Thanks, Pat. We have 100, so whole-time equivalents, we have 151 staff, 25 in training currently, and we shortlisted 68 more people today. When we said back we would need 500, we were using a stat that told us that a call would last 45 minutes and it would be 10 minutes per contact, with an average of 3 contacts. That's where that number came from. We have refined the call. We have brought the time of the call down. We have technology that's also alerting people.
Sorry, yes. Olive. How many of the 151 are full-time?
I will get you that. I don't have that right at my fingertips. You'll appreciate that we offered a contract for a year. So the majority of people that have come to work for us are people who have retired, have come back from retirement and have taken a 20-25-hour contract for us. Small number of people...
You're telling me you don't have a figure of full-time...
I do have it. I will find it. It's in front of me here. I have the figure. I will give it to you. So if you just give me a moment, yes?
Okay, so when community testing and tracing was halted on the 12th of March earlier this year, we are told that there were 12 people involved in contact tracing. And at that time, there were 47 confirmed cases of COVID-19. So let's say, even for argument's sake, 120 of that 151 are full time. That has risen tenfold. However, the number of positive cases yesterday has risen over 30-fold. So was the modelling for 300 not a disastrous underestimation?
The modelling was based on... the modelling was done for us by the experts based on the disease profile, and we were working towards... In fact, it said... If things deteriorate.
Sorry, all of what experts were doing the modelling?
Jerry, do you want to pick that one up? So Dr. Ian Young, Professor Ian Young, and some of the other experts helped us with the modelling based on the disease profile.
So it was the chief scientific officer who underestimated the number of infections that were going to take place?
No, I don't think that's correct. I think based
on... Brilliant if you're saying that.
Based on many factors in the community, and as Dr. Waldron said, people complying with the good advice that we were given, that was the estimate. It was an estimate. It was not... You know this is not an exact science. So, but in relation to our ability to flex up, we responded, as I told you, we have responded the number on the 2nd of October went from 300 to 900 in a day, and we flexed up. We have technology that's helping us. We have extra staff coming in to help us to flex up, and we have responded to the demand, and we will continue to respond to the demand. We had a workforce appeal, and we have 100 plus people interested, and we will interview them again this weekend. We have three people training where we had one. So we are offering training every day. We have very expert people who are working with us, and we will continue to build.
And Olive, we are hearing of dozens and dozens of cases where people haven't been contact traced. And I'm sure you're aware, all of you are aware, that the countries that have dealt the most successfully with this virus are the ones that have the most rigorous and robust testing and tracing systems. Now, all of you in the room there are very well paid. You were tasked to put in place a rigorous and robust contact tracing system. You have failed abysmally. The contact tracing system that's there at the minute is as useful as a chocolate fire guard. And who among you in that room is going to raise your hand and say, I'm responsible for this failure?
Pat, you know I'm the chief executive of this organisation, so I am responsible. And I can't accept that you have said that this is that you compare the service that we have set up to a chocolate fire guard. I think it's a disservice to the staff who have volunteered and have come and worked for us. We will
continue. It's not about the staff, it's about the leadership.
No, the leadership is me. The leadership is me. So the team and I have worked all summer. As we said, we were the first ones to set up a contact tracing service. We piloted in May. We have built technology. We have built an IT system to support it. We have attracted staff. We have built and trained very effective staff. We will continue to do that. We are reaching over 80% of people every day. The contact tracing service is a very vital part of breaking the chain of transmission. But we collectively, as leaders, including yourselves, need to make sure that the messages are that everybody is complying, that we are socially distancing, we're washing our hands, and we are complying with the regulations we heard about later. So in relation to contact tracing, we have an effective service, and we will continue to build on it to deliver for the safety of people in Northern Ireland.
No, Olive, we don't have an active service.
As part of that answer to Pat, the majority of people, the 151 people, are on 20 to 25 hour contracts?
Pardon me?
Did you say in response to Pat that the majority of people, of the 151 people who have been recruited, are on 20 to 25 hour contracts?
No, they range from one day a week to full time. We have people working more than full time. We have people now working from home remotely. Where the numbers go up, people will flex up for us, and they will take those calls on into the evening and over the weekends. So we have a flexible model that is flexing up and down. We went from 300 one day to 900 the next, and we flexed up.
Okay, so how many full-time equivalents then, given that range? How many full-time equivalents?
Sorry, I did find it. So people who have taken a full-time contract with us, and the contract is for 1 year.
Olive, I'm not asking that, and you know I'm not asking that. I'm asking how many full-time equivalents overall is at your disposal?
We have 100 people who work full-time, 37 hours for us, we have 20 people. People who work part-time, we have 45. People who will work on the bank, and the average person on the bank works 20 to 25 hours for us, but will work up to and including 40 or 50 hours, which has happened for us. We have 86.
Olive, I'm going to interrupt again. The reason we use the phrase full-time equivalents is that captures how many hours are being put in. If you don't have that figure today, that's okay. If you don't have that figure today, that's okay. But can you get us that figure? How many hours are committed? Because there's such a range of contracts there that it's impossible, and that's why the health service uses the term full-time equivalent.
No, I understand what you're asking me now. To do 1,000 cases a day, We know at 30 minutes, we need 40 staff available to us every day. Is that helpful?
How many staff have you available? How many full-time equivalent staff do you have at your disposal today working in testing and tracing?
Can I just a second just to say, I think the question is a very reasonable one, and I understand why, if I was in your position, I'd be asking that question. And I think we will seek to get you an estimate figure. I think the difficulty for the Chief Executive is that the figure changes literally day by day, and we initially set the system up as a surge capacity model. So with a core staff were there every day and a large capacity to flex day to day. So it was not conceived of in terms of full-time equivalents. It was conceived of in terms of a core staff and a flexing staff. But I think the question is a reasonable one, and we will seek to get you a figure as of the current position.
Okay, I'm going to move on because I have other members indicating, but we do want that figure, both what you have and also I'd like the figure of what you estimate at this point, given the very significant underestimation there's been, what you are proposing to the department you need in terms of full-term equivalent. So I would like to know the level currently existing and what you assess you need. I'm going to go now on the phone to Colin. Colin McGrath, are you there?
Yes, Chair, and I think, Chair, eternally they'll say that politicians avoid answering questions, but I think we've just seen a class example of it there from officials. Chair, I'd like to ask a question about the track tracing app, and this is as much a personal experience as it is anything else. I'm very concerned that there is going to be some fatigue amongst the public and that there potentially will be members of the public that will switch off the app, deactivate it, and not use it because they are very concerned about having to spend 14 days in isolation. They feel that if they're obviously not getting an income or a vastly reduced income during that period of time, that is going to be too difficult a decision for them. But my experience from it is that you're asked to isolate for 14 days from the alert. But the alert comes at the response of somebody uploading a positive test case, and their first symptoms may have been 4 or 5 days before they get their positive test result, but it may be up to, in some cases, 14 days prior to them uploading that they were actually last in contact with you. And I suppose my question is there any way that we can narrow the gap between, in some way, that app, the COVID app, can tell you when you need to remove yourself from self-isolation because the app can determine when you were last in contact with the person that then consequently uploaded the positive test result. I appreciate it will require a little bit of work in the background of the app to determine that. It doesn't need to tell you who it is, but if it can just tell you that maybe it was 5 days, 6 days, 8 days previous, whenever you were actually in contact with that person, that length of time could be deducted from your 14-day period of isolation and means that you then don't need to spend 2 weeks. Because in that example, if it was 13 days ago when you were last in contact with the person and you get the message today and isolate for 14 days, from start to finish, that is 27 days. And I think that if people were getting messages that said you need to isolate for 6 days, 8 days, 9 days, there may be a bigger buy-in to it. And are there figures available for the number of people that have deactivated the app or indeed have removed the app as well to see is this going to be something that we need to work out? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Health Committee, for time to talk to you today, and thank you, Colin, for your question. I note that you had already written to Minister Swan on that topic, and understandably that letter has made its way onto my desk, so you should be expecting a response imminently on that. The reason why we had originally triggered the 14-day self-isolation period at the point that the positive test code was uploaded into the app is about privacy. When you had relatively small numbers of people using the app, if you were started the self-isolation clock at the point that there was the last risky close contact with an individual or individuals who have a positive test, it would theoretically be possible, particularly for somebody who isn't out and about much, perhaps one of the shielded population, to identify the individual that triggered that self-isolation advice and therefore an individual in the community who has contracted the virus. And so for those privacy reasons and in concert with the Information Commissioner's Office, that's how we set up the design of the app in the first place. Now that we've got more users, your point is a great one, Colin. Should we revisit that decision and start the self-isolation timer at the point that that most recent close contact occurred? We are in the process of investigating that, and it's highly likely that we'll implement that change, as you've suggested, in a future version of the app. So that's under analysis at the moment, and we will both respond to your letter and obviously respond to your comments today accordingly, and we'll keep you and the Health Committee updated on if and when we then make that change. Your question about do we know the number of people who've either deactivated or removed the app for the reasons that you've outlined, or indeed any other reasons, we don't have that information, unfortunately. We do have some information on usage of the app, and I can outline some of that today, but that's one fact due to the privacy considerations and the way the app stores work that we can't discover, unfortunately.
What is the usage of the app? Do you have those figures in terms of how many people have triggered it and then how many people have received the appropriate warnings?
Yeah, absolutely. So our stats are over 450,000 people have downloaded the Stop COVID NI app. So this is the proximity app, recognizing there are two apps in the COVID app ecosystem. The number is 452762 for those that are writing that down. The number of text messages that we've then sent to individuals that have had a positive test result, saying if you are an app user, take this code and enter it into your app so that we know you are you in terms of reducing misuse of the system. That's 16,535. 3,659 app users who've received that SMS have uploaded that into their app. And the relationship between those two numbers, the number of people who are app users and have uploaded their diagnosis keys compared to the number of individuals who've got a positive test that have received the SMS, is about a correlation between the number of people in the population in total and the number of people that have downloaded the app. So it's about a quarter. 11,580 app users have received a contact notification and have been advised to self-isolate. So that's the group of numbers that we tend to talk about in terms of efficacy of the app. That relationship between the number of individuals who have had a positive test and have uploaded the keys, and then the number of individuals that have been identified through an exposure notification is as good as, and actually increasingly becoming better than, the number of individuals that are identified as part of that manual public health contact tracing process. And that's one of the measures that we'd agreed with the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency as a test of efficacy of the app in obtaining the appropriate CE markings for a medical device according to the MHRA regulation. There are some other stats that I can wheel out for you, Colin, around the number of cases that we're exchanging across the border north-south, but it may be that that's better to just leave.
Can you hear me, Dan? Yeah, Dan, can I suggest maybe that you forward the committee a written briefing in terms of those? We are very interested in them. I just don't think we want to maybe utilise the time today in going over them, but I appreciate that they're there, and we certainly are keen to get more information. Just if I can refer you back when we have you on the line, Dan, and I'll go back then quickly to Colin, but Pam had asked how is the under 18 app working and what's the uptake, just in very brief terms, please.
Sure, brief terms. So there was a new version of the app launched on the 30th of September. It's not a different app, it's just a new version of the one that we had released on the 30th of July. That original version, you'll remember, was for over 18s only, and that's due to a constraint around the consent process for people under 18 to use publicly provided digital tools. The consent process is by its design identifiable. I, parent or guardian of this individual, consent to them being able to use that service, whereas our app, as you all know, is designed to be very private. But we knew that not having the app used by that younger population was an issue for us, particularly given how motivated they are to use digital services if you can get it right. So we worked following the release of the first version with the Information Commissioner's Office, the Children's Law Centre and the Children's Commissioner to develop a new onboarding process that would, in the public interest, allow individuals under that age range, the 11 to 17 year old post-primary age range, to be able to use the app. And we designed that onboarding process with kids rather than a load of grey-haired old men and women sitting in a room and designing that. We actually did that in conjunction with
Dan,
children.
Dan, can you give us how many, how it's going and what is the uptake? What is the uptake on the under 18 apps, please?
We don't know how many people under the age of 18 have downloaded it because we don't know who's downloading it. But what we do know is since we've launched that new version, the number of people downloading it and using it per day has increased from about 3,500 to about 4,500. Okay. So we have a marked increase in usage and are continuing to work through the schools and head teachers to promote the use of the app and integrate it with policy and protocol within the schools for carrying mobile phones and contact tracing.
Okay, and again, we would appreciate any further updates you have on writing on that. The committee are certainly keen to that and wish that system all the very best in terms of how it operates. Going now to Alex, we're running pretty short of time, so Alex.
Right, I'll try and do very quickly. How useful would it be if everybody in Northern Ireland had a mobile phone download the app, please? I'll just do my second last question. Are you able to trace people who are actually breaking the isolation rules that they're meant to be isolating? I'm just curious as to how you're doing that. Thank you.
If I take the app question first, the app is one tool in the public health toolbox. It's by no means the only tool, obviously, as we've been hearing earlier on today about the contact tracing service. If everybody downloaded it and installed it, we know that the app would become increasingly useful in breaking chains of transmission and alongside increasing compliance in the public with self-isolation guidance, that will have a significant impact on our ability to reduce infectivity.
Thank you. And the panel on the other part of that question from Alex?
Yes, if I could maybe deal with that one. We haven't any way of knowing who's complying or not complying. I think it's taken back to the enforcement question we had earlier on in the session. We put out the message. We make it clear to people who are both positive cases and contacts of positive cases what their obligation is. If they're a positive case, they need to be self-isolating for 10 days from the onset of symptoms. If they're contacts of confirmed positive cases, they need to be self-isolating for 14 days. And that is the message. And I hope we've been quite clear in putting out that message to the people. We rely on people to follow that advice. It's really important that they follow that advice. And if they don't, we will get to see the situation where the numbers will continue to increase. But it's an important message that people need to be taking on board. And we haven't any capacity at the moment to be able to monitor that and check on people. We're relying on people to do the right thing when they find themselves in that position.
Okay, thank you. A quick one from Paula, and then we're going to have to go into a consideration of this.
Yeah, no, thank you. I just wanted to come back on that of no way of knowing and no capacity. Is that not something that you should be actively pursuing then? Because I think the message coming out of this today maybe would be for people who get the text message, well, I don't need, there's really very, very slim chance that I'm actually going to be penalised or caught on for this. So I think the reliance on people doing the right thing is probably that those days are gone and you need to be looking more at the enforcement and the monitoring.
Well, I'm not sure if those days are gone. I think if those days are gone, we're in really big trouble. We had a situation in the first wave where the people of Northern Ireland took the message to heart. They knew what they had to do. The message is still very, very clear. And it is up to every one of us to be putting out that message, but also to be taking that message to heart if it applies to us. That going beyond that, and I'd even go beyond that, that the way things are at the moment, we should all be making the assumption that everybody we come in contact with throughout our daily lives, including ourselves, is potentially infectious and act accordingly. I think we really can't get into the situation where with the numbers we have, but even if it wasn't the numbers, it is a respiratory virus. It's highly prevalent within our community. We rely on people's behavior and their good behavior and to do the right thing. And I think we should be confident in our people that they will be taking this message to heart and doing the right thing.
Can I supplement that just saying, by there is lots of international evidence around this, not around COVID, but around other diseases, for example, like tuberculosis. And people across the world have experimented both with what I would call the altruistic kind of appeal to people's better nature or the more enforcement kind of approach. And with infectious diseases over the last, you know, over many decades, the evidence generally is that from a behavioral science point of view, the altruistic approach tends to work better than the enforcement approach. I am also concerned that if as a society we move very strongly in an enforcement approach perspective, then as we phone people up and say, who have your contacts been? They will be less and less transparent with us in relation to that the information that they would give us, and that might have an adverse impact in the longer term in our capacity to contact trace. So I'm not against enforcement, and it's, you know, as a philosophical, as Jerry said earlier, if somebody organises a rave and there's a bunch of people there, they are acting criminally irresponsibly, and that is that should be enforced. But there are people who are embarrassed about the fact that they have gone to something that in retrospect they regret, and if they do not feel free in a clinical situation to confide that clinical information, we may end up in a difficult situation. Thank you.
Okay, and given that you have just said there, Dr. Waldron, that you don't have the capacity to monitor, nor indeed, I presume that means you don't have the capacity to support, as just has been discussed there, to provide that ongoing support to enable people to do the self-isolating. Is that another indication of a failure within the testing tracing support system? And have you, as public health officials, put forward any proposal or business plan to the department to get additional capacity and resource to deal with that?
We have been, and we're very grateful for all the assistance we've been getting from the department throughout this. They have been very, very helpful in giving us additional resources. But this isn't just about resources. This is about the ability to respond to an ever-changing situation and also to respond proportionally to it. And I just have to say that I've been in public health for over 30 years. I've never come across any situation that even touched this in terms of the intensity and the longevity. Most emergencies are over and done with, even the swine flu, within a month at most. This has been going on, from our point of view, since early January when we first heard about this. And I am absolutely awestruck when I'm looking at my colleagues in the public health agency in terms of how they've risen to the challenge. And I don't think we need to be hearing about things like failure. I don't use the word failure. I use the word success in terms of seeing how extremely dedicated individuals working in the public health agency have coped with this challenge and are managing new and increasing challenges every single day of the week. And it's as Olive said earlier, it's a 7-day week now. And we continue to do that, and we will continue to do that, because our responsibility to the people of Northern Ireland is to ensure that we deal with this very serious and unprecedented challenge in our midst, and we will continue to do that as long as we have the power to do so.
Yeah, and we do continue to support that. We are, as you say, we are now 8 or 9 months into this pandemic, and it is our duty and our role as a committee to identify what's working and not working, and what's not working. And it is, I have to say, staggering to find out today that there's been an underestimation of 300% in terms of what the capacity was needed. So that is obviously an area of concern. But I do want to thank you all for coming today. I want to wish you all, we all recognise it's hugely important work. And we do We do wish you well in that. I'm going to go very quickly to Alan. I hadn't an indication from Alan. I'll take it, but we do need to move
on. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I just want to go back to some remarks that Pat Sheehan made earlier. And I want to completely and utterly disassociate myself from them, where he referred to this system as being as useful as a chocolate fire guard. And I would call on the parties in this room this morning to join me in disassociating themselves from those remarks. I think they're very unfair, very uncalled for, and very unhelpful. And I think Pat doesn't need to look any further than the leadership of his own party to find evidence of chocolate fire guards in relation to trying to stop the spread of this virus within the community.
Okay, members, I'm going to allow the PHA to get on with their important work and to thank all members of the panel, and we can then have a discussion in relation to what we have heard and what we think we would need to be doing as a follow-up in relation to that. Thank you all very much for attending this morning, and good luck. Okay, members, sorry, I have Pam indicating, and then I'll go to Paula. So, Pam, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Could I concur with Alan's comments there? I am quite horrified yet again that members of this committee would treat professional panel members in the way that these people have been treated today by Pat Sheehan. And I want to absolutely disassociate myself from his actions and say that this is not appropriate behaviour from any member of this committee. And to be referring to the panel before us today and start talking about their wages and how much they're being paid, I think was absolutely disgusting. And I think Pat should actually apologise.
Okay, ma'am, Paula.
Yeah, I would concur. I think that maybe some of the language, and I myself at times have got quite passionate in this health committee. It's a very stressful time for us all, but I think that today probably just went a step too far. But I wanted to come in on a different point.
Yeah, go ahead. Oh, this is a discussion around the evidence that we have heard.
Okay, well,
all elements of
King's College London, they did a survey last, I think it was late September there, that said only 18% of people who were asked to self-isolate actually did after developing symptoms. So I am concerned about this lack of monitoring, and maybe I think that they thought that I was more looking at the enforcement, but it's more, to come back more to your point, it's more the monitoring of following up to make sure they're full. You know, because if people are out and about in the community when they're clearly at high risk, even if they haven't shown symptoms, I think that that's very worrying. So I think we need to keep on that issue.
Okay, Jerry.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Pat can speak for himself if he wants to, but to me it just seems, I mean, there's fundamental questions over this whole approach, and it can be convenient for executive parties or members who parties are on the executive to kind of criticise the approach, and I'm all for criticising the approach, but there are parties who are on the executive. That's an obvious contradiction.
Chair, I can't hear Chair's remarks.
So what I said is Pat is obviously able, if he wants to speak for himself, but what I'm saying is, to me, there's obvious questions over the system. I'm not convinced whether we have enough capacity, and I didn't get that guarantee today.
Sorry, Chair, I think maybe the Chair needs to speak to the mic.
I am, sorry, I'm not doing it a third time, apologies, because I'm repeating myself.
Could you try this other mic, Jerry? Maybe there's something wrong with that mic. Try this other mic to see if it picks up any better.
Is this better?
Can you all check that you're on mute on the? Can everyone on the phones check that you're all on mute, because that's what was creating the problem earlier, we believe. Colin, you're not on mute.
No,
Colin,
sorry.
Colin, I'll bring you in a minute. Just mute there for a sec. Right, Jerry. Sorry.
Third time. Look, hey, sure. Thanks. Is this okay? Can people hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks. No, what I was trying to say for the third time, Pat can speak for himself if he wants to, obviously, but I think there's fundamental questions over the system and whether it's fit for capacity, whether it's big enough. I mean, obviously, we all recognise the work that staff are doing in the test and tracing system, but I'm still not convinced whether it has enough capacity. So I think there's a point on that, and I think that's a question for the whole executive and for the whole executive parties. I asked the question, I didn't get an answer. If anybody else picked up on it, how many tests in total have been carried out? We've agreed to have a zero COVID strategy as a committee. I don't think that system is in place, so I think there's fundamental questions over that. I think there wasn't enough clarity on that. And to me, the obvious point today is that there seems to be more testing to be rolled out, more staff to do that, and the same with tracing. That's my two cents.
Okay, thank you. Alex?
Yeah, I certainly think that we're not necessarily getting all our questions answered by them there, and I do feel maybe there is a capacity issue. However, I do feel that we can ask our questions. I think there's a way we can ask them in a way that doesn't come across as being very aggressive. And I do have to say that the aggression at times in some of the questioning is, I find it very difficult to listen to, and it makes me feel very uncomfortable. And I want members to ask their questions, but they don't need to do it in such an aggressive way. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I have to say I am concerned. We are only after having to bring in measures which are going to have a significant impact on people's lives, on their livelihoods, on their mental health and well-being. And we have a duty as a system to ensure that we are doing everything we can. And I am taken aback to hear that there was such widely off the estimate in terms of what was being planned for or needed in relation to this. And I think that is a legitimate area of concern for the committee. I would propose that we write to the PHA and ask them to provide us with some specific information in relation to today's questions that haven't been answered around the issue of how many tests have been carried out, how many whole-time equivalent staff they have at present, and how many whole-time equivalent they believe they need to cope with the situation at present and in the future, and what capacity of positive cases are the PHA currently planning for, given that the estimate they had been working on has gone out the window. Would members be content that we write to the PHA in that respect and consider how we move forward following that? Yes, Colin. Go ahead, Colin. Sorry, I had forgot to come back to you there, Colin. You're right. Yeah.
Chair, I think born out of frustration maybe was the reason that maybe, you know, Pat spoke the way he did. And I can appreciate that because I was frustrated. I'll even go a step further. Chair, I'm down here in Newcastle cringing at the answer that was given to us by the PHA. And I actually think that we should be writing to the Health Minister. I would guess, and I'm probably not far off the mark, that there was over £500,000 worth of annual salaries sitting in a room, and they couldn't tell us in the middle of a pandemic how many full-time equivalents are dealing with tracking and tracing. Now, I ask this question, seriously, £500,000 worth of the top team of our public health agency, and they couldn't tell us what the full-time equivalent dealing with contract tracing in the middle of a pandemic. And I think if we set that down on a bit of paper to the minister and then just reflect, why was Pat a bit frustrated at not getting an answer to his question? And I think we should be writing to the minister and asking him if he thinks it's appropriate that his lead people dealing with this virus and outbreak don't even know how many staff that they have. And then we should reflect on what the public purse is paying them.
Okay, and Pat?
Thanks, Chair, and I appreciate some people may feel uncomfortable. What actually makes me feel uncomfortable is that thousands of people are contracting this virus, and many of those people are going to die. And we have to sit here and listen to waffle and people avoiding answering questions. I have been going on about the importance of contact tracing and testing from the very start of this pandemic. The PHA have had ample time to put in place a rigorous and robust system that would find the virus, trace those involved, isolate them, and support them. And they haven't done it. It's as simple as that. And the operation they have put in place is as useless as a chocolate fire guard. It's as simple as that. And under no circumstances would I apologise for saying that.
Mr. Chairman, yes, I think I wouldn't have expected any apologies from Pat this morning. It seems that Sinn Féin don't have that in their capacity to apologise for anything. And it's concern for the spread of this virus. I wish he had had that concern, and the leadership of his party had had that concern at the Bobby Storey funeral. And I think also it's quite clear this morning that the SDLP have no wish to disassociate themselves from this type of language. And I do think that it's wholly inappropriate for us to be making remarks around what anybody's salaries are. I think that's quite disgraceful.
Okay, members, so we have agreed a number of actions, and there's also been an additional suggestion there. I think, if I'm right in capturing it, that we copy the minister into our letter to the Public Health Agency, and we also add to that letter message to the minister that we are concerned at the lack of detail that the PHA were providing at this meeting today, and that the preparedness of the PHA to complete their part of the find, test, trace, isolate and support system. Are members content with that?
And the testing, Chair, yeah. And the request about the number of tests carried out, yeah.
Yes, that's included. So a number of tests, number of whole-time equivalents, and how many whole-time equivalents they're seeking, and what capacity are they planning for at present? Thanks. Paula?
I would like a question, even just a concern that I have, not sure whether the whole committee share it, but around the lack of monitoring or the need that is actually something that as the services develop, that this is something that they build in, and whether it needs to be with the council or police or whoever, but I do think that there needs to be something there to back up the work.
So what is the question?
It's really just about consideration to be given as to how, because I think the words we use there is that we have no way of knowing whether people are self-isolating, and I think that's very worrying, and it's really just about can they give consideration to how they could incorporate that into the service.
Yes, and I think that should include both monitoring and support where necessary. So can we include that to both organisations? Okay, Matt. Yes, Pam?
Yeah, a couple of things. Obviously, I had more questions than I was able to ask in that session, but I would have concern around health and social care workers and the impact that the app may be having on staffing levels. If staff maybe are forgetful and forget to turn off their Bluetooth or whatnot when they're going into a COVID ward, the knock-on impact is that they will be notified, and the trust is standing over the need to that they cannot take the risk and they have to put that staff member off for 14 days. And given the pressures that we're under, I think that's a serious issue. So I would have asked the PHA what their commentary was around that, or if they're working with the trusts to deal with that matter. And I also just wanted to say there that actually I withdraw my call for Patchian to apologise, because Sinn Féin don't apologise for anything or don't take any responsibility for their actions in regards to public health message and adhering to rules, guidance, regulations. So there's no point in even asking for an apology, because we know you're good at not apologising. Well done.
Okay, and are the committee content to add Pam's question in relation to the impact of the Stop COVID app on healthcare staff and staffing levels to both organisations, to both the Minister and the PHA? Are members content with that?
Yep. If Pam's happy to say an amendment, because can we ask if staff are being asked to turn off their Bluetooth? Because I've been told that.
That is the issue that is raised that for.
Yep.
Okay, members, thank you. We are moving on then. We are now moving on to taking the departmental briefing on the October monitoring and main estimates, and we'll take a very short break just to get the officials on our line. Thank you. Thank you, members. So we're moving on then to our departmental briefing on October monitoring and the main estimates. Item 6 there, can I advise members that departmental officials are here today to brief the committee on the October monitoring round and the main estimates. I refer you all to your papers at tab 6 of the pack and the clerk's memo at tab 6 of your table papers. So I'd now like to welcome by video link Mr. Andrew Dawson, Director of Infrastructure and Investment, Ms. Ciara Dolan, Director of Transformation, Ms. Fiona White, Head of Financial Development, and Ms. Annette Palmer, Head of COVID-19 Finance. So could you please now go ahead and brief the committee official? Thank you.
Sure, thanks very much for your time. I'll apologise for saying I'm a reasonably last minute replacement for Bridget, so I'll apologise in advance because I'm not as polished as her on this. But I'll start by giving you an overview of the resource capital and COVID-19 positions. And these are listed as appendices A, B and D in your papers. And then I'll hand over to Ciara to give you a brief overview on transformation as set out in appendix C. So starting with resource then, appendix A, paragraphs 1-4 go through the history of how we got to the current position, with table 1 showing the opening budget position. The section on June monitoring at paragraphs 5-7 details the bids we made and outlines the funding we received at that time against those bids, with table 2 then providing you with the current position prior to going into this October monitoring exercise. As part of the assessment of the October monitoring position, we engaged with colleagues in the department and in the wider HSC system to identify any mainstream budget pressures that needed to be funded at this time. A significant part of this work assesses the current forecast position in relation to HSC trusts and the likelihood that any pressures identified can be further managed as we move through to the end of the financial year. Overall, the position is much more volatile and harder to predict this year as a result of COVID-19. But our latest estimate of the amount of additional funding we would need to receive to enable the system to break even is the £15 million bid set out at paragraph 10-12 of Appendix A. In relation to palliative care, paragraphs 13-14, you will be aware that our £5 million bid in June monitoring was unsuccessful. Having undertaken a further assessment of the costs associated with this service, an inescapable pressure of £1.5 million has been identified and submitted at this time. And as set out in the paper, this would enable the provision of an adequate rapid response nursing service. While successful in our bid at June monitoring in relation to elective care, we have reviewed the potential to provide further services in this area given the and have identified a bid of £1.5 million, which will deliver additional elective care activity for dermatology and plastics to ensure that suspected cancer patients can be treated within clinically appropriate times. This is detailed in paragraph 15. And the committee will also wish to note that one further late bid of £6.3 million, and this is not detailed in Appendix A, was submitted by the department to address non-agenda for change pay pressures, largely in respect of medical and dental staff and the need to align to UK-wide inflationary pay increases. Then, at Appendix B of your briefing paper, the department's opening capital allocation for 2021 was £295 million. Paragraphs 2-5 detail that the department submitted.
Andrew, sorry for cutting in there. It's a wee bit hard sometimes just to hear you. Could you just speak slowly and clearly? It's the quality of the sound, not the quality of your voice, but the sound's a wee bit ropey, so maybe if you could just... thank you.
Yeah, sure thing. I'll just start the capital section again. Turning to capital then, at Appendix B of the briefing paper, the department's opening capital allocation for 2021 was £295 million. Paragraphs 2-5 of Appendix B detail that the department submitted the following successful bids totaling £38.7 million at June monitoring, £4.9 million for a number of Invest Save schemes, and £33.8 million for the department's COVID-19 pressures. In addition, £27.6 million of funding was held pending further clarity around capital funding and requirements for COVID-19 and the end-year flexibility position regarding Encompass. You may recall that this was brought up at the June monitoring and end-year flexibility was not confirmed for the Encompass programme. The department is therefore having to absorb the £48.1 million pressure from within the 2021 budget allocation and the 27.6 million that's been held pending further clarity has been allocated to mitigate this pressure, with the balance of the funding being provided through internal reallocation as a result of reprofiling of expenditure forecasts. In summary, therefore, following June monitoring, the revised capital budget for 2021 was 331 million. October monitoring in respect of capital then is detailed at paragraphs 6 to 9 of Appendix B.
Sorry, Andrew.
As part of October monitoring,
Andrew, I just need to cut in on you again. Apologies for that. I think we've identified that the problem may be that some of the other officials who are on the line may not have your phones on mute, and that's what's causing the cut in and out. So could I ask Kira, Fiona and Annette just to check and to place your feed on mute, your mic? Put your mic on your system there on mute, please, for us. We're not seeing it here in the room so far. So are any of you, so if you move your cursor on the screen there, it should bring up a series of options, one of which is a little microphone, and you need to click that to mute it. Okay, we'll move on, Andrew, with your, and could Kira, Fiona and Annette just please continue there, see, can you get your system onto mute? Go ahead, Andrew, please, we'll persevere.
Okay, thanks. I'm more than happy to go on to mute at any time. Do you mean to go back any at all? What was the last bit you'd heard there?
You were just... Just at the capital section there, Andrew.
Yeah, sure. So following June monitoring, our revised capital budget for 2021 was 331 million. And then our October monitoring approach is detailed at paragraphs 6 to 9 of Appendix B. As part of October monitoring, our armed strength bodies were asked to review and confirm full spend of their current allocation and to notify any reduced requirements. Given the known pressures as a result of COVID-19 and the wider ICT programme, arm's length bodies were asked to identify any urgent inescapable bids that could not be contained within existing capital allocations. Our October monitoring bids therefore fall under two main headings: capital pressures, detailed at paragraph 8, and COVID-19 capital bids, detailed at paragraph 9 and table 1 of Appendix B. In relation to capital pressures, we have not been able to allocate to our arm's length bodies additional funding for general capital, which is used to maintain the estate, purchase essential medical equipment, and to maintain fleet. Our arm's length bodies have submitted a number of inescapable pressures totaling 6.7 million for general capital items, and we intend to submit a bid for this funding, and we have indeed submitted a bid for funding to the Department of Finance in October monitoring. Turning to COVID-19 capital pressures, the department's arm's length bodies continue to submit pressures for a range of critical projects for a second surge and short-term rebuilding measures to establish a safe environment for staff and patients. The COVID pressures were previously submitted to the Department of Finance as part of the Executive's Economic Recovery Strategy exercise in the summer, but only 1.6 million of funding was secured from this exercise, and that was for the Test, Trace and Protect project. The COVID pressures are currently now estimated for capital to be in the region of 33 million and cannot be met from within the current budget allocation. The department therefore intends to submit, and has indeed submitted a bid to the Department of Finance for this funding in October monitoring. And a summary of the requirement is detailed in Table 1. We're also making a number of technical adjustments, detailed at paragraph 10. And then just at paragraph 11 there, there's a note on risks. And in addition to the normal underlying risks surrounding potential programme slippage, the prevalence of COVID-19 presents a risk for projects at or nearing construction stage, and as such this may have an impact on our ability to spend our budget allocations planned. There's also the potential need for additional funding in relation to COVID-19. Where possible, we will try to contain pressures from within our existing allocation. However, we may need to submit further budgets in the next, further bids in the next monitoring round. Turning then to Appendix D and COVID-19 resource pressures, you will see at paragraph 2 that overall we have identified the need for some 526.4 million of the 600 million funding that's being held by the Department of Finance. And a breakdown of the figures has been provided for you in Table 1 of Appendix D. Again, forecasting our needs in this area has been incredibly complex and indeed extremely challenging. And this represents our best estimate at the current point in time. But hopefully you'll appreciate that the evolving nature of the pandemic means it's impossible for me to give you the kind of assurances over accuracy figures that I would normally and the department would normally both expect and wish to have at this time. In particular, you will see that the cost of rebuilding and second surge have been separately disclosed. The second surge figure is estimated based on our experience of the first surge, with an attempt then to factor in the fact that it will likely occur during the winter period when the system is already usually under strain. However, as it's impossible to predict the exact nature or time frame of the second surge and how long it will last, these figures are inherently uncertain. The nature and timing of a second surge is also likely to have an impact on the extent to which our planned rebuilding measures can be implemented. In addition, a number of these are still in the early stages of planning, and hence the estimated costs are still high level and subject to revision. A worse than expected second surge will likely mean that less money will be spent on rebuilding, which could then provide us with a source of additional funding to deal with any additional costs arising. And I'll now hand you over to Ciara to talk about the transformation position.
Okay, and before we go across to Ciara, can I remind all members on the panel there, online, to mute your microphones. Go ahead, Ciara, please.
Thank you, Chair. In terms of transformation, members will be aware that the fund is worth $94.4 million this year, which is composed of the initial budget allocation supplemented by additional funding secured at June monitoring for NDNA transformation priorities. Members will also be aware that the funding requirement for NDNA transformation identified at June monitoring were not met in full. The total value of the bid was $36.17 million. However, the $14.6 million secured did allow for all transformation bids to be supported to some degree. Following the June monitoring outcome, project owners advised that they had modified their plans to live within the resource available. For October monitoring, the focus was on those unmet June monitoring requirements, with HSCB and senior policy owners within the department asked to consider whether additional bids were needed at this time. The outcome of that engagement was that no bids for additional resources for transformation were forthcoming. Spend within the Transformation Fund is closely monitored, and through this monitoring, a range of easements and pressures have been identified across the portfolio of projects. Given learning over the last 2 years and the impact of the first COVID surge had on the system, it is likely that additional easements will arise as the year progresses. And as such, I am assured that the easements and pressures that have emerged can be met from within existing resources without the need for additional funding at this time. This is obviously, as Andrew has said, a very fluid picture, with this latest rise in COVID cases likely to have an impact on delivery and spend and transformation projects. The position will continue to be closely monitored to ensure early identification and mitigation of any issues that arise. Thank you.
Thank you, Ciara. And are we going to some of the other then? Are we going to Fiona? Or are we back to yourself, Andrew?
We're just back to me. That's the end of our statements. We're happy to take questions. I think Fiona and Annette are here, hopefully, to bail me out on the resource side if I start to fumble. And Ciara is well on the transformation, and I'm here on the capital side of things. So we're ready to take your questions.
Okay, thank you. Well, my first one is on resource there, actually. And I know there's been 15 million identified. The department have asked us for 15 million savings. We are very cognizant of the very difficult situation. I'm also very cognizant based on what you said earlier, that we are indeed facing a worse second surge than was anticipated and planned for. So that is a concern. But the department is bidding for $15 million to alleviate the savings targets set for trusts. So my question would be, how far that $15 million is expected to go in reducing the demand on trusts to cut their spending? And if that bid is unsuccessful, what the department's proposed approach would be to addressing that difficulty?
Okay. So, as I understand it, there is a current forecast deficit of $30.8 million, and a bid of $15 million was agreed to be the most appropriate to submit through October monitoring to assist in managing the current forecast trust deficit position. As the department will continue to work in conjunction with the board and with the trust to seek to identify opportunities to mitigate the current deficit position, as you would expect us to do. So, and when we hope and anticipate that will bear some fruit, and therefore the judgment was taken that half of the required deficit was submitted as a bid to the Department of Finance at this time. I think there's an acknowledgement that this approach carries a significant amount of risk, but based on the patterns of previous year's activities, reductions in required funding do emerge towards the latter part of the financial year, and tightened timing contributes to spending constraints, etc. So, a second surge may also further reduce costs, as I said, on the rebuilding, for example, as well. And again, I think in terms of managing in the future, there is a future there will be another, as I understand it, as in every year, then another monitoring round in the winter time, December, January time. So again, in terms of the 15 million figure, I suppose it was a judgment made in terms of the size of the current deficit plus the usual actions that might be taken to try and reduce that deficit.
Okay, thank you. In relation to my second one is in relation to elective care, and I note that the additional $1.5 million has been bid for. How would that additional $1.5 million be spent, and what kind of impact would that be expected to have on waiting times? And again, the committee are extremely conscious of the very extensive waiting times and the very, very deep impact that is having on people. So how would it be spent, and what impact would you hope to derive from that, Andrew?
Okay. So, I mean, I think we would agree entirely that it's completely unacceptable that any patient has to wait longer than they should for assessment or for treatment. On the $1.5 million, the bid submitted through October monitoring is in order to provide additional capacity to undertake independent sector dermatology treatment to enable review and treatment of cancer patients to clinically appropriate timescales and ensure adequacy of patient care. In terms of numbers, it's intended to deliver an additional 1,160 new assessments, 940 review assessments, and 1,148 inpatient day case appointments. If this proposal is not taken forward, there would be insufficient dermatology and plastics capacity within our system to ensure that suspect cancer assessment and treatments are provided within clinically appropriate timescales. And obviously then any delay in assessment would have detrimental impact on patient care and outcomes. So again, very clear that the $1.5 million is in respect mainly of independent sector dermatology treatment.
Okay, thank you. And then my final one is on transformation. And the department's previous advice had been that $81 million was the estimated requirement to stand still in that respect, but also that some projects were delayed due to COVID-19. So, to what extent the $94.5 million of funding will allow transformation to continue and progress? And finally on that, to inquire what the additional funding for MDTs is expected to deliver? And a number of us attended meetings recently where that lack of access to MDTs is crucial for many, many conditions. So, could you give us your update on that, please, Ciara?
Yes, surely, Chair. In terms of the $94.4 million, that's covering all of the inescapable costs that were identified from the projects which started in 1819 and 1920. So that was just keeping the projects on the ground and moving, cognizant that we didn't want to lose the progress that we'd made over the last 2 years. The additional, the 14.6 million that we got from June monitoring, which made up the 94.4, was put to projects that needed to, new projects or projects that needed to grow. I have a breakdown here in front of me in terms of what that 14.6 million is delivering, Chair. It's quite detailed. Do you want me just to give a kind of a very high level run across all of the projects that 14.6 million supported?
Just a very quick, okay.
If there's anything you need me to get into more detail on that, that's happy to do that. So in terms of power to people, there was £1.7 million given to that, test new models for domiciliary care, to do more work on the strategy for the social care workforce and to support training in the independent care sector. £5 million of the June monitoring money went to NIAS training to increase the supply of trainees that are going through the foundation level training for a new Bachelor of Science qualification, which is mandatory from next year for paramedics. £0.3 million went to the Protect Life 2 strategy, which is in addition to money that's already in different areas of mental health from the inescapable pressures money. And that £0.3 million was to progress crisis de-escalation policy work and to work on safe messaging and on local Protect Life implementation and stigma work. There is £1.22 million has went to advanced nurse practitioners and GP practice nursing, which is really to enhance the support the primary care is getting through those practitioners, and to free GP time to support the areas, you know, both in COVID response and in non-COVID response, particularly around COVID centres, and earlier to allow earlier intervention in primary care around mental health issues, which are definitely bubbling up in primary care. £0.3 million of the June monitoring went to the Northern Prototype work, which is really working to put in place more effective and sustainable service delivery models with an integrated approach between secondary care, primary care, and across the whole HSC. One of the key things that the Northern Prototype work has done in recent times was to see a rapid response to COVID in terms of setting up 3 COVID centres in the Northern Trust. And there's also good work being taken forward in the Northern Prototype in terms of supporting care homes. So virtual ward rounds being undertaken to cover weekends and out of hours. So there's good work going on there and being supported by that additional £300,000. Pathology was one of the big areas. Pathology was one of the big areas, £1.5 million, really to support the continued transformation of pathology services. And whilst pathology, obviously the testing is going to have additional money through COVID, there was a transformation that had already begun in terms of changes to the management structures within pathology, reducing variation in clinical practice and improving recruitment and training and retention, which all needs to continue despite the additional money needed for testing. £0.4 million went to developing nursing home inreach, so enhancing clinical skills and leadership of staff within care homes, really important in supporting our COVID response. £100,000 went to the Homelessness Hub to build on the work that's already ongoing there in Belfast Northern and Western Trusts, rolling that service out, to the Southern and the Southeastern Trusts. And that Homelessness Hub, the work around that in light of COVID really supported that vulnerable community and gave a huge protection to them in the response to COVID. I'm nearly finished, honestly. I know I'm going on a bit, but it's important.
I'm just checking here. I'm not checking you. I'm just checking to see if members are indicating on the system. That's all I'm looking at, so go ahead.
Okay. Yep. 300K then went to the Mental Health Recovery and Co-Production Project, which is helping the community and voluntary sector organisations to develop peer-led relapse prevention, and also to help those community and voluntary organisations to become independently constituted registered charities to, you know, to be self-sustaining and to generate their own funding. £0.2 million went to quality and safety, which is really sustaining the HSC's Quality Improvement Institute, which has been very important actually in leading the innovation work stream post-COVID as part of rebuilding to identify innovative practices that have come up in response to the pandemic and to try and identify them to roll out across the service. Also, £1 million went to the implementation of the Urgent and Emergency Care Review. That's in terms of progressing sustainable models of care in regionally, establishing a network and local implementation groups to put in place the new systems and pathways to make sure that people can continue to get safe and appropriate care, but at the same time to continue to protect the EDs, particularly in this winter period. And that work has been undertaken in line with the No More Silos action plan the department has produced. I don't want to take too much time, not get into too much detail, but in terms of children's services, almost £1 million, 0.88 million went there, 0.27 million went to support in phase two of the day case elective care centres. £190,000 went to support the regional rollout of the dermatology photo triage, and Chair, to your point on primary care MDTs, just over £500,000, £0.54 million went to MDTs, and that was really to support the further rollout in the five existing areas. It's, you know, we can't roll out into any further areas on the funding that we have this year. But the money that we got through June monitoring is helping to support the further recruitment from existing recruitment lists, but also to focus more predominantly on recruitment in mental health, given the impact that COVID is having on people's mental health. There's also 0.13 million pounds went to oncology prototypes to recruit in respect of therapeutic radiography. And then 0.54 million went to the NIAS clinical response model. That's less than they needed, but it's they're using it to take forward the program team to develop both the revenue and the capital business cases for the full implementation of the clinical response model when they get more money to do that. Okay. Sorry, I know I went on a bit. But,
Thank you, Ciara. Yeah, thank you, Ciara. Thank you very much. I'm going to go then, first of all, over on the phone to Pat Sheehan. Pat, go ahead. Could I suggest, members, that we take one question each at this stage and see how we're getting on, because we're under quite a time restraint now. So, Pat, go ahead.
Chair, just a quick question. I wanted to know if there was a particular line in the budget in relation to health inequalities.
Yeah, panel, please. Andrew, did you catch that question there? The question was, is there a line in the budget relating to spend on health inequalities?
I don't have that information exactly to hand at the moment. I know that a lot of our budget does deal with health inequalities, whether it's a single line or not. I'm not entirely sure, but I'd be happy to catch up unless Fiona or Annette would have that information. I don't have it to hand, unfortunately. I don't think they would have it in the briefing pack either, so we're happy to write to you on that point.
Yeah, and actually we have raised that issue before, Andrew, and it's something we are very keen to address. We have wrote before on this, and it's been outlined that it runs through everything, but we're asking you to provide us with the breakdown of detail. So if you don't know what you're spending on it, you surely don't know what impacts you're having. So we would like to see more detail in relation to that, rather than just it's running through everything. We appreciate that it is, and we would expect that it would be, but we cannot monitor the progress of it if we don't know how much is being spent and dedicated to that and what it's achieving. So I think we will want to come back to you in relation to more detail on that. But for now, I'll move on to Gerry first and then Paula.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Ed. It's very detailed but worthwhile. Just in regard to the trust's funding, the Chair kind of obviously raised the point about June, but sort of when will we know that decision? Because we're being asked to effectively endorse something. I don't know when we'll know that when that £15 million will be accepted or not. And is there any other trust pressures or requirements or suggestions for reductions in funding? I couldn't see it in the pack, but if there's any information on that, that would be useful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just on the timing then, This is a briefing then on what we had submitted as the Department of Health, as all other departments have submitted in respect of bids for October monitoring, and including that 15 million. The outcome, I think, then is being considered at present by officials in the Department of Finance, who then put recommendations to the Minister of Finance, who then brings them to the Executive. I'm not cited on the exact timetable for that, so we are awaiting that as well. In terms of the exact actions that are being taken by trustee, and there's a wide range of actions. Probably, again, it might be worth, I don't know if we provided a breakdown in writing, because again, I don't have all of them to hand at the moment, but I think it might be, trust by trust, it might be useful, I think, if we were to give you a bit more detail on that in writing.
Okay, thank you. Paula?
Okay. Firstly, I would like to know when the committee is going to get the response to the letter from August, seeking clarification on whether PrEP is going to be funded under the transformation funding, as Ciara had indicated at the June meeting. So that's a couple of words in response. But my main question is really about palliative care and the £5 million bid that was unsuccessful. I think you did touch on it slightly there, but I am very concerned, given what we are taken as evidence in our inquiry into COVID and care homes, that the restriction on family members being able to provide care to their loved ones on a daily basis as a care partner. I think that in many ways more money should be going into palliative care and our care homes as opposed to less. So if you can talk to us about the impact and how it's being mitigated. Thank you.
Ciara, do you want to go first on the transformation query, and then I'll deal with the palliative care?
Yes, surely. Apologies if a response on that hasn't been sent. I'll look into that and come back to the committee as soon as I possibly can. I thought it had.
No, I think it's still outstanding from the middle of August. But I actually wrote to the I wrote to the permanent secretary at the start of July asking for clarification on your comments, and I still haven't received that either. So. It's more a frustration. It's a small element, but I think that it speaks to the contribution to the committee.
A huge apologies, honestly. I will look into that today.
Thank you. And going then back to the phones to Orlea Flynn. Orlea, are you there?
Sorry. I haven't addressed the issue of palliative care.
Oh, sorry. My apologies. The issue of palliative care.
Sure thing. The budget going into this financial year, the opening position for 2021 had a shortfall in palliative care of 7 million. And just to set it in context, and as you say, 5 million was bid at June monitoring, none was received. And I think the update was then that had made the priorities that had been detailed in New Decade, New Approach, unachievable at that time. And with the inability to deliver those priorities then, due to the funding constraints, a revised approach was required. Through the consideration of the inescapable pressures required to deliver what we could in terms of critical palliative care services in 2021. And again, I think that then reached the conclusion that would be constituted in the continued provision of the rapid response nursing service in partnership with Marie Curie and specialist palliative care and palliative care educator staff. And that rapid response nursing service is what has resulted in the identified bid of 1.5 million in October monitoring. If successful, this investment would continue into 2021 and would ultimately form part of the wider investment to meet then the New Decade, New Approach palliative care priorities, which themselves have a recurrent investment need of 9 million in 21-22 and 10 million onwards from 22-23.
Okay, thank you. And going then across to Orlea on the phone. Orlea, are you there?
Yes, thank you, Chair. First of all, thanks, Ciara, for that update around the transformation. There was some interesting detail there around some of the mental health bids. I wonder if we get that right, it would be great. And then just my question is around, in the briefing paper, it was mentioned around that the COVID pressures are estimated at 33 million and that these couldn't be met from within the current budget allocation, given the need to meet the pressure for Encompass.
And my question is if maybe you could provide some rationale for around that Encompass project and also around the bid that was made for a digital rebuild. Because I would just like to know how projects such as that, not that it's the right thing to do, but how that was prioritised given the pressures around, COVID, around the trust budgets, around elective care, people with cancer, and things like that. So just a wee bit of rationale, please. Thank you.
Sure. I'll try. There's a lot in that question. I'll try my best to answer it. You can come back to me if there's anything I haven't addressed. So yes, the 32.4 or just shy of 33 million, I think, in relation to COVID pressures was in relation to COVID capital pressures. And as you say, then part of the thing that we're struggling with at the moment is the consequences of the Encompass underspend, which was detailed June monitoring. So again, just to set a bit of context around that. So if we take the 7.2 million allocation from October, in October monitoring, we would allocate 42.7 million to Encompass, and then the remaining 5.4 million would be found from the overall IT program. You're right in terms of there being consequences of that Encompass underspend. That the 48.1 million that we've had to accommodate within our capital budget, and you've asked about rationale for how we make, you know, how we make decisions elsewhere. The 48.1 million would have, for example, been used to provide additional general capital to money to trusts and to smaller arm's length bodies. So far this year, for example, we've allocated 35 million, where last year we had allocated 60 million. So again, it's just a matter, I suppose, of just trying to manage within the existing budget. And again, it's a judgment call as to how we do that. We would also have taken forward things like low voltage works on the Craigavon area hospital site. We would have had a bit more fund towards the department's in-year COVID pressures, and we'd have allocated additional funding to our technical enablement project in order to try and reduce the headline spend on that next year. So again, I suppose in terms of rationale as to how we manage things that don't happen because of managing the Encompass underspend, we really, it's just careful consideration between ourselves and colleagues in the service. I'm not sure if that has answered your exact question. I'm happy to take a follow-up. Yeah,
no, and thanks for that. I suppose it was just whenever I was writing over the briefing paper, and as I said, you know, there might be really obviously genuine good reasons why so much money needs to go towards the Encompass programme and towards that digital rebuild. But I'm just thinking in the context that we're in with the pressures that the health system is under and with the priority being COVID and then also the cancer stroke, the elective surgery, all the important things that like need to be happening to save lives in the immediate term. I'm just trying to sort of, get my head around how so many millions can go towards, supporting digital rebuilds and an Encompass programme that could maybe wait until we've got over the difficulties around the COVID pandemic.
Sure. So Dan West, who was on earlier, won't thank me for commenting too much on the Encompass programme, other than to say that I think it is, it's a real priority. It will be something that will make the system run much, much more efficiently in the future. I think that there once you start down a massive program like Encompass, it's hard or impossible or expensive to stop. Again, once you stop, then you also lose the momentum that then again ensures that you lose time further on down the line and you don't get those things done. So it really is just a question of balances at the moment. I don't have a line by line analysis of Encompass, and I'm not sure if I could sort of detail to you today what is contractually committed, for example, or what's obliged to be done and what will be more expensive to stop doing or to undo at this stage. But I know that there are all those considerations which go into play then as to why you don't stop it, okay, or why you provide cover for something like Encompass.
Okay, thank you, Andrew. And I'm just checking then with Pam. Pam, your hand was raised there. Are you looking for a question, or your hand is now down? Okay, I'm not picking up Pam there. Okay, members, thank you, and thank you to our panel. I think we will need to... Yep. What's that, Clark?
On the spotlight, but she's muted.
Pam, you're muted there.
Oh.
Pam, you're on mute.
Thank you, Chair.
Yep, go ahead.
Yes, just quickly, I wanted to ask around the rationale for the lack of bids in October for transformation, given the pressures. I mean, I think obviously this is a very challenging time with COVID-19, but it would also, you know, seem to me as a lay person looking on that it's also a time for opportunity and a time to actually transform while we are in this crisis, because any resumption of services, even in a different way, will be welcome as opposed to not having that service there at all. So could you give us some rationale on why there's been no bids for transformation?
Absolutely, Pam. And, you know, I suppose that's a question that I knew would come up, because it's an obvious one in terms of, you know, the need to transform and regenerate our services, and that's what we are doing. There was a significant bid for transformation in June monitoring, which was in June, and the reduced amount of money that was given to projects meant that the projects did modify the plans that they were that they were putting in place. So, you know, for example, the children's services projects, it just reduced the amount of capacity that they were going to be able to meet in terms of their projects. Some of the projects said that they would work at risk and go ahead, such as the oncology prototypes, the development of the network for the daycare elective care centres, and just raise pressures elsewhere then if they couldn't get the money through transformation. So the project really did kind of mitigate what they were going to do and work within the resources available. October then obviously is we've moved on substantially and significant things have changed. We gave projects the opportunity to bid for more money, and at that time the money wasn't forthcoming. I am seeing slippage in areas of projects already, and given the experience that we've had over the last 2 years, as Andrew said, that you know the slippage that you do see in the last quarter of the year. And given that there was a relatively small underspend in the 200 million transformation fund, which was attributed in many ways to the impact that COVID had in sort of January, but more so February and March, I expect to see a greater underspend in projects that can't be delivering as they had expected to be, because this impact of COVID is hitting now in October, November, December, January. So I do fully accept to see a level of slippage that I'm going to then monitor on a monthly basis. I say monthly, more like a daily basis at this point, you know, so that we can, meet the needs of transformation projects that are ongoing. The projects that said that they were going to work at risk have already started to see a reduction in their risk, because they know that they can't maybe do what they had planned in June. But there is a significant amount of transformation that's ongoing within the urgent and emergency care. The urgent and emergency care got £1 million from transformation, but has also got money through COVID to roll forward quickly. And, you know, the work that needs to be done through no more silos. So it's not that transformation isn't happening. It is, and it's happening right across the system. But the money that we have is sufficient at this point to meet the transformation needs that we can deliver. And ultimately, transformation really is dependent on the resources available to deliver these projects above and beyond the project or the services that are on the ground. We've always said that. And if there's going to be a big redeployment of staff to the front line, it's going to impact on our ability to deliver transformed services.
Okay, thank you. Just one final one, just in relation to back in January, during the nurses' strike over pay and safe staffing levels, and there was a commitment that they would receive the money to cover that, and the money was actually allocated by the finance minister. So why is that still not being paid, Andrew? And we had raised this at the last monitoring round, but why is that money still not being paid to the nurses?
As I understand it, the our Minister of Health had been asked to bring forward proposals to enable the award of the funding to be made to health staff and health and social care staff. As I understand it, the matter is still under consideration by the executive in relation to potential repercussive impacts.
Okay, thank you, and thank you to panel members for coming along today, and we wish you all the best in the future, and thank you for briefing our meeting this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, members, just arising out of that, there is that issue about the issue of inequalities and how we follow that money sort of through the system. Would be an idea. They have responded to us, but I'm just not. I'd like to go back and have a look at the response, but maybe we should look for some further detail, or maybe even a session, an evidence session, in relation to how they allocate that money and how they monitor it and follow it through the system to see that it's making an impact. Would members be content if we take that approach? Go ahead, Paula.
Definitely. I think that it would be useful then to put a lot of that then in the context of either the department strategies or public health agencies or health and social care board, because you know, we know that there are some really good work out there and good strategies. It's just really how that money's flowing down into the ground under the grassroots projects.
Yeah, okay. Okay, thank you, members, then. So we'll move on then to, we now need to consider two statutory rules regarding travel restrictions, which we referred from last week. Can I advise members that a departmental official is here today to brief the committee on the provisions of these regulations? We may need to take a very short pause to get Mr. Brian Dooley on the line. Okay, we're going to pause for a few minutes. Okay, members, we will continue on with our consideration of these SRs. We're considering two statutory rules regarding travel restrictions that we deferred from last week. Can I advise members that we have not been able to get the department official on the line, so we will discuss questions that we may have or any issues we have now with these SRs. So I'll take the two SRs together, and can I ask members for their comments or questions in relation to either of the SRs? Gerry?
Yeah, Chair, I know there's obviously an ongoing issue with information and data and our rates, and I think that's being still processed, but there's an outstanding concern about that, and I think we should emphasise that we need that as soon as possible. I mean, this isn't facetious, but is there also merit in asking, you know, given our high rate of infection, higher than America, and one of the highest in the world, is there a question of whether people should be encouraged to come in come here? So I don't mean that as a flippant or a facetious question, but something as genuine and something that I think has to be considered. So I don't know if that can be added into a letter as well, but something that I think has to be addressed by somebody.
Okay, thank you. Members, any other members wishing to indicate a question in relation to this? I think one of the key things that I would have been looking to explore today was the issue of there are a number of areas outlined, including a number of specific in relation to the elite sports. There's reference to cricket teams and things like that, but I'm just wondering how much of this is a cut and paste from other, and how much of it therefore is not kind of specifically tailored to our specific circumstances or geography or needs at any given time. So I think I would like to know more of the process as to how they transpose what's been drafted elsewhere and apply a local kind of filter to that to ensure that we are doing additional things, or if there are things that aren't relevant to us, they're not being included unnecessarily. Would members be content with that? And we have also asked a number of previous question members around these SRs in terms of the evidence that's used to underpin them. Would members be content that we reiterate that we don't object to the SRs today, but we reiterate our concerns in relation to that level of detail? Members content with that? Yes. Thank you. So do I need to formally put the rules in? Okay. So I remind members that Department of Advice is SR 2020/203 broadens exemptions from self-isolation rules in relation to various categories of persons connected to elite sports, film production, and those having travelled as part of the fourth national licence competition. In addition, Ciara Kiao Denmark, Iceland and Slovakia are omitted from the list of countries and territories in respect of which travellers arriving are exempt from post-travel self-isolation. If members have no further issues with that, can I ask members to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR 2020/203, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment Number 12, Regulations 2020, and has no objection to the rule. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Great. Thank you, members. Moving on then to SR 2020/212, and this SR omits Bonaire, St. Eustatius and Saba, Poland and Turkey from the list of countries and territories exempt from post-travel self-isolation. If members have no additional issues they wish to raise in connection with this statutory rule, can I ask members to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR 2020/212, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment Number 13, Regulations NA 2020, and has no objection to the rule. Are we agreed? Thank you, members. Okay, so moving on then, members, to any other business? Forward Work Programme members, sorry. Can I draw your attention there to... I'm just having to go back through my pack. Members, in terms of Forward Work Programme, can I refer you to tab 17.1 of your pack there? Are members content to note the Forward Work Programme? Yeah. Gerard?
Just on it, Chair, for guidance. We obviously agreed about members kind of coordinating different meetings. I'm coordinating one for the 27th of October. Is it best to work through the Ailish and the clerk team in terms of dates and Microsoft Teams and all that? Is that the best way to do that? Yeah, okay.
Yep, go ahead, sir. Is that the best?
Happy to talk to the member after.
Yep. Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Alex?
Oh, any other business?
Yes, I'm just coming on to it. Okay. Yeah. So, are members content to note the Forward Work Programme? Yep. And then moving on to any other business, do members have any other business, Alex?
Yeah, I was wondering if it's possible if the committee agreed and we have time, if we could maybe call the Chief Medical Officer. I'd be very keen to get rationales and information about the decisions that are being brought to the executive about the COVID-19 regulations and stuff, and just to drill down what he's actually bringing forward, because we're not seeing sight of that or getting information. And I think he's the main man that we should be really drilling about what's actually going on. So it would be helpful for me for the future if I knew more information about what we're actually agreeing to and why certain things are happening.
Okay, Alan?
Just in relation to that, Mr. Chairman, I mean, the Chief Medical Officer presents his evidence to the executive. It's the executive that considers that evidence.
Yep.
And they can reject it, they can challenge it, they can query it, and they arrive at their collective executive decision. I thought that we had taken the decision some weeks ago to invite the two junior ministers along. We weren't sure whether that was permitted, but I think we subsequently found out that that was appropriate. I'm just wondering on an update on that, because I think that perhaps Alex concerns around that could be answered by the two junior ministers, since they're part of the collective that actually makes the decision. I think the Chief Medical Officer, his job is to present evidence, but he's not a decision maker as such.
Alex?
With respect to Alan, I hope he doesn't think I'm not having a go at you, but it's Chief Medical Officer and the Chief Scientific Officer here making the recommendations to the Minister, who bring it to the Executive. So he's the one that's making up the reports, and then the Minister's following it. So I want to see more clearly what the person who's making the recommendations, why he's coming to those decisions. It's not the Health Minister or even the Junior Ministers. It's the Chief Medical Officer who's making these recommendations, and he's the one I want to get the information from.
Okay, I'll go to Jerry, and then I'll wrap up in terms of or try and pull together what the committee wish to proceed with.
Chair,
I'll take you in a minute, yeah. Pam. I have Jerry first, and then I'll come back to you, Pam. Yes,
sure. I'd be for both. I don't think it's either or. I think the CMO should be coming forward to the committee, and I think we should try, if possible, beforehand, because sometimes things are lost and questions don't get answered. We should try to ascertain beforehand whether that seed advice 3 weeks ago was presented to either the CMO or whether he had any input in that. I'm assuming people know what I'm referring to there. But if we can get that before any appearance or put that in writing, that would be helpful as well. So I'm for him coming in.
Okay, and Pam.
Thank you. I would agree with Alex and Jerry there, actually. I've no objection to either the junior minister's coming before us or the chief medical officer. I think it would be good, and I think it would be good to have on record and have a bit of time to actually delve into some of the issues, because I think a lot of people in the community have genuine questions and would be interested to hear what the chief medical officer in particular would have to say on the subject. And I'm sure he's more than able to cope with a session with the health committee. So I would welcome either of those options, or both, or all together.
Okay, very, very quickly, Alan, please.
It's another item.
Okay, well, on that item, can I suggest, if members are content, and I think this is, that considering we are the Health Committee, that we start off with the Chief Medical Officer, and then potentially we consider any other witnesses from any other area. So members are content with that.
Well, just, Chair, I mean, a decision has already been taken by this committee to invite the junior ministers. What I'm asking is for an update. Where is that at the moment? When are we meeting them, or when are they appearing before us?
I don't think we have taken that decision, Alan. I don't recall that decision being taken. I remember it being discussed, but I don't recall the decision. I will ask the clerk to go back and check through.
I'll ask the clerk to
clarify. Yeah, we'll go back and check that, and we'll bring that back. But I don't honestly recall it at this point in time. So, members content that we invite the Chief Medical Officer to a session. I also want to say, just before, sorry, Alan, I'll come back to you on any other business. I should have said, in relation, I had noticed to go through the SRs a couple of things of drafting issues that I thought were in there that maybe we should draw to the attention as part of our letter. But there was, on page 80 of the pack, there was reference to amendments in paragraph D, subparagraph 1, a definition of a domestic elite sports person. It appears that should have been C1, and I think that's just probably a typographical error. And on page 81, there was in the amendments, there was a reference to a British film definition in Schedule 1 of the Films Act 1985, but there was references of it being a part of the EU system. So as we come closer to January and the impact of Brexit, I'm just not clear if that is a miswording in relation, or if the travel regulations are robust enough in terms of Brexit, the Brexit situation. So are members content if I give the detail of that to the clerk, and that is included in the just for accuracy? Okay, thank you, Alan. Your other.
I just want to flag this up today, Chair. A constituent contacted my office just this morning, a parent, to say that their child was due to receive the flu vaccine as part of a program in the school next week. Now, I don't know whether that's a universal program across all primary schools or whether it was just unique to this particular school. I need to check that out.
It is universal.
The parent is raising the concern that their child will now not be able to receive that flu vaccine next week and will be without protection for a number of weeks that can be reprogrammed. So I'm not really sure where we go with it, but maybe ask the Department of Education what alternative plans are in place to facilitate this at a future date.
Okay, members content to ask the department to clarify that. Okay, thank you, members. Moving then to date, time and place of next meeting. Our next meeting, Pam, we're totally out of time. Yes, Pam.
It was on AOB as well, very quickly. It's just Jerry referred to the committee having taken a position on zero COVID strategy or something. I'm just not aware. I would like the clerk somebody to check that. I don't remember us taking any position on
that
issue.
I do recall the committee had had noted the document from Independent Sage in relation to Zero COVID, had written to the Minister and asked him for his comments in relation to that document. So that was the position as far as I'm... We haven't received that correspondence from the Minister.
Yes, so Chair, just for clarity then, we don't have a position... The committee doesn't have a position on adopting a Zero COVID strategy then?
No, we were seeking the minister's views back to it. It is regrettable, I have to say, that correspondence hasn't been referred to. It is a significant issue and probably one that we will need to come back to in that respect. Okay, members, date, time, and place of next meeting. Our next meeting will be on Tuesday, 20th of October. Pat, we're out of time. What is it, Pat?
I've had my hand up for the past 10 minutes.
Go ahead, Pat.
Just in relation to the evidence that was given by the chief executive of the PHA, she said that the original modelling in terms of the number of cases they were expecting required them to recruit up to 500 contact tracers. She then said that modelling was changed, and she said it was Ian Young who was in charge of that. And then when I asked her if it was Ian Young, she said no. So, I mean, it would be interesting to get some clarification around that issue.
We have asked for clarification around those issues. Okay, members, we are out of time. The date, time and place of our next meeting is on Tuesday, 20th of October 2020 at 1 p.m. in room 30. Thank you, members.
This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Senate Chamber programme signed. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly.